This climb just twists and turns steady halfway up. We'll go through a little village. A great stopping off point, a wonderful place to watch the tour go by. And then it will continue on to the summit as the road kicks and rears, especially in the last kilometer. Field here holding steady tempo. Everybody silently suffering on the climb. All they'll hear is each other's hearts beating and the rasping of breath. And today, Paul, they're going to be, the sweat is going to be running down their legs and their arms. It is so hot.
This is huge heat. Normally you would expect the heat to disappear a little bit over the mountain summits, but today at the top of Luz-Ardiden it's creeping up to around 30 degrees Celsius. That is a very hot temperature for the top of one of these mountains. And there isn't too much wind in the air either, so the riders will be gasping for oxygen. This is the best ride we've seen so far in the tour of Udo Bolt, and he is now trying to set something up, I'm almost certain, for his man Jan Ulrich. On the far side, the iBonesto.com rider accelerating the pace there is Denny Menshov. He's a Russian rider on the Spanish team, and the Spanish teams today, Phil, almost right on the border of Spain, will certainly be looking for the big victory.
Absolutely right, and they're going to get it if they get their way. They've worked out the tactics, of course. They know that Ulrich is going to be watched by Armstrong, and they're gambling now that Armstrong will allow them their chance to win the day. You can see from the plane here the yellow jersey standing out quite clearly. A familiar jersey now being worn by Lance Armstrong, looking set to win his third Tour de France, but there's still a long way to go. Lance was getting rather annoyed about everybody saying how easily he wins the Tour de France and how easily he counters the attacks and how easily he makes them. He said, you guys should come and see me in January when I'm working hard, training and getting myself in shape to do just that. I think he has a point.
He has a serious point, and one advantage that Armstrong has, I think, in the fact that he trains specifically over all of these mountain passes, is he knows them when he comes to race over them. But he comes hungry to race, which is different to a man like Jan Ulrich, who comes into the Tour de France with about 60 days of racing in his legs. On the other hand, Armstrong only has about 35. And when he hits these climbs, he really wants to give it everything. Now, this is a bit of a surprise. 91 here is the man who was the white jersey in the Tour de France last year, Mancebo. He's being helped along there by his teammate Leonardo Pipoli, and it's surprising to see this man in difficulty.
Well, I'm so surprised. I was wondering if he was being helped back, but I think he is in having a difficult day. And Mancebo in difficulty, and this very select group again is forming at the front, and it's just being formed by the steady tempo riding. Let's have another look at that, because here's Mancebo. He looks as though he's coming back, Paul. I'm wondering if in fact he had a problem.
Well, he's riding on the tail of his teammate Leonardo Pipoli, but now Garzelli has decided he wants to go off. He's got no reaction at all coming from US Postal Service. You see, they are riding on a completely different plan today. They're not bothered about responding to attacks of riders who are more than 30 minutes behind in the overall standings. They're quite happy to let these attacks go off the front. They just want to set a steady pace, but one man who must attack and probably will on the last climb of the day is Jan Ulrich.
Now we're looking here at Podzi, who's one of the survivors of the seven, and it looks like he's in a bit of bother and is now being dropped by the others, which will leave Vladimir Belli, Mario Ertz, David Moncoutier, Bobby Julik and Sven Montgomery up front here. One by one they are cracking under the strength of the afternoon sun here in France. It's coming up to 4 o'clock in the afternoon. I can't remember a day in the Pyrenees so warm at this stage. This is a wonderful day if you're watching the Tour de France. It's a real tough day for the riders who are making the race at the front. Mario Ertz, Paul, is a surprisingly good climber, number 62.
He's ridden well in the mountains, although not absolutely high in the standings as he would like to be. He's now today looking for some glory for the Lotto team, who really haven't had that much glory at all. They lost their sprinter early on in the tour, Jeroen Blijlevens. And now these are the kind of stages where a man like Mario Ertz has a chance to get himself a stage victory. But there's an awful lot of aggression in the group behind trying to come across on the far side. The tall figure is that of Axel Merckx, and he's trying to ride himself up to the leading group of riders on the road.
Well, he's making progress, and so is Garzelli, who's just left the main field. We've got the five leaders, then we've got Podzi, then we've got the three survivors of the breakaway, Goubert, Clodin and Robin. Then behind them, we've got Cardenas in that small group containing Axel Merckx. A lot of riders are trying to take their chance here, get away, form at the front, and then speed down the other side and into the town of Luz-Saint-Savoie, and then they've got a chance at the finish.
Well, this looks like Roberto Lyseca, a man we saw earlier in the day in serious difficulty at the back. But, you know, for this team today, they want to try and get the victory. They've tried many times before, and this is quite a shock. This is Hamilton coming off the back of that group. We saw him doing his work for the team. He's had a very hard Tour de France. That little sign there saying bottle, and that's exactly what he wanted right now, just to keep himself topped up with fluids. Tyler now will just ride to the finish and leave the Spanish riders alongside Armstrong to accompany their teammate for as long as possible on the last climb of the day.
So he hasn't fully recovered at all, and an Euskaltel rider also waving goodbye here, Zubeldia. And they've not got many of their riders left up there either now. Lisaka was definitely off the back earlier. He seems to have recovered and gone back up to the front and away from the front. But there's a lot of riders here still in difficulty at the back. This is Gert. No, it's not. Yes, it is Gert Verheyen. He's just gone past there. And number 97 is Odriozola, who was originally up front trying to catch the 10 breakaways. Didn't make it and slipped off. Here is Mansebo, still in difficulty after the attack of Garzelli. This is an amazing situation here. Riders we never thought we'd talk about are struggling at the back of the race on the climb of the Tourmalet. This is the leading select five, spearheading a trail up the Col de Tourmalet. And the USA's Bobby Julich got himself back onto the sharp end and looking pretty good.
Another move trying to go off the front here. This is Carlos Sastre of the Once squad, and he's been joined by the man who won a stage a couple of days ago, Felix Cardenas, the Colombian rider who took his victory on the Colombian National Holiday. And you can see they're weaving their way through this very huge crowd that's assembled here on the slopes of the Col de Tourmalet. And I would say, Phil, that nearly everybody who was on Plat d'Aday came down and took a left-hand turn to try and put themselves here on the slopes of Tourmalet, because this is a great place on a day like this to watch the Tour de France. If these riders right now can just tilt their heads up a little bit, they will see that the summit is way above them at 2,115 metres.
Well, the situation on the road at the moment, five riders in the lead. Oscar Podzi, who was with the lead, has dropped, and Stefan Gubert with the lead as he's dropped, but still chasing. And these two are coming up to them now, Carlos Sastre and Felix Cardenas, and behind comes the advance part of the peloton. 2:20, I suspect that is a time check to these two riders here, who are steadily climbing up, and it looks as though they've found some friends on the left. I think they're supporting the Euskaltel team. Yes, they are. They're all from northern Spain. Here we are now as we look down here. This is Bolts, and it looks as though he has come back and has gone right through the group there, Paul. That's a shame. And this is also Vinukarov, also in the spot above her, and Rubiera as well.
A lot of pressure on the front of this main field right now. Most of that work, I would expect, is being done by Guerini and Livingstone for the moment. This is Guerini on the front. He was brought into this team to look after Jan Ulrich in the high mountains, a winner himself of that legendary stage, the Alpe d'Huez, after a dramatic crash with a photographer by the name of Eric, but he got up to finish the stage and take the victory. But you can see right now that Telecom today want to blow the race apart once again, and all that Armstrong has to do is match the man in the white jersey there, Jan Ulrich, a man he regards as the most talented man in the world of professional cycling. But Ulrich today saying in the press, Lance should stop saying that, because I might be talented, but he's certainly the strongest.
Oh, that's a nice comment too. But they are tapping out the rhythm at the front, as they've done early on. Of course, it's always been Lance Armstrong who's had the final laugh by jumping away on the last climb of the day. Three mountain top finishes in the Tour de France this year, a vicious stretch through the mountains, added on to the Alps when they flew between the two, with just one day's rest in the middle. These are the leading five as we continue to climb up the Col de Tourmalet, this mountain which just goes up and up, high into the sky where nothing grows towards the top. It is just a snow line right on the top, which stays right throughout the year. And making the pace on the right is Mario Ert, enjoying the presence of the day. Sven Montgomery in the centre of our picture, the leader of Française des Jeux, one of only two teams left in, with all nine riders heading to Paris. On the far side there, Vladimir Obeli, who made his name on television in June when he socked that spectator who was throwing things at him, and as a result was disqualified from the Giro d'Italia.
These riders started to lose a fair amount of their advantage at the bottom of the climb. They had 4 minutes 15 seconds and is now just outside of 2 minutes. The main field obviously accelerating, and most of the work being done by Jan Ulrich's Telecom team. The men in pink on the front end of the main field, and they today are looking to set Ulrich up, I think, Phil, for a possible victory.
breakaway is now losing tempo a little bit. That was Moncoutier sitting behind Bobby Julik. At this nearest camera, Vladimir Belli. These groups of riders here are trying to get up now. This is Lyseka, who got away a little bit earlier on. And Pipoli, and they're trying to keep the pace up just that little bit. Two more are chasing across the gap in Carlos Sastre and Felix Cardenas. But really, the spread over all of them back to the Lance Armstrong. But there is Sastre and Cardenas on the right, so they've now caught up with these three off our camera and are trying to make progress towards the leaders. And there's more just ahead as well. So the leaders are steadily but surely changing at the front, but Julik, first over the Col d'Aspin, is still with the front five.
Very complicated race to organize on a race like this, because there are attacks coming all of the time. You have to be calm and collected in the group if you're a man like Lance Armstrong. Just keep an eye on who is going off up the road. Garzelli was the man setting the tempo in that group, but we still have a leading group of five riders. In this leading group, it's Mario Ertz on the front who's setting the pace, and he's not very far now from the banner indicating 2 kilometers to go to the summit. An interesting little sign at the side of the road there in Flemish, VDB, where are you? Well, nobody knows that at the moment. That's a sign for Frank van den Broeke, the man who is so talented in the sport of professional cycling, but he's having a real hard time psychologically. I think he's actually changed his bicycle for a fishing rod.
Yeah, well, he won't get many tops of the Tourmalet on a fishing rod, but in fairness, we would love to see van den Broeke come back into the sport because he is a super talent. Anyway, these are the chasers now. Garzelli allowed his head as well. He's been joined by Sastre, and Menchoff has got up. And they've got themselves together now, this little group. And watch out for this man, Cardenas, because he has shown us now he's an absolute flyer.
I think there must have been attack from behind there, because, in fact, you could see the race organizer with the red shirt on the bike there. He was pushing all of the motorbikes out of the gap. I think that's because the group here of Ulrich, Livingston and Armstrong are actually starting to close on that small group containing some very select climbers. Lyseka today looking for the victory for the Euskaltel Euskadi team. And, in fact, at the front of the race, Bobby Julik finally under pressure here. He can't hold the tempo of the four riders in front of him, but he must try and survive over the next kilometre and a half just to go over the summit within 20 to 30 seconds. And then on the descent, he can take a few risks. But behind, the pressure is now really starting to pick up, and they may well catch these guys before the summit.
Bobby, every time the pace accelerates that little bit, holds his own tempo, can't lift it just to match up to Mario Ertz. It's unusual to see a good Belgian rider on the front like this, but he is a good climber, Mario Ertz, and especially on a day like today. Sven Montgomery, the Swiss rider, just off our camera to the right there. Vladimir Belli, we know, is a good climber. Bobby Julik was in hot company. These are good riders at the front, even though they've lost a lot of time in this year's Tour de France. Garzelli wants a result somewhere along the route to Tour this year, because here's a man who won the Tour of Italy last year, a past winner of the Tour of Switzerland. But this is becoming an amazingly select bunch. Just tempo riding has ridden the field away off the back. It's down to just 11 men, Paul.
Andreas Klöden has been caught now by the front end of that group with Jan Ulrich, and he's trying to set the pace for Jan Ulrich. You can see he's accelerating. He recuperated for a kilometre or so, and I think, in fact, Kevin Livingstone has cracked there. He's going further back down the group. This is definitely a very select group. 151 there is Santiago Botero. 29 is Marcos Serrano on the far side. 24, Igor González de Galdiano. These are all the big names, but Team Telecom are starting to crack right now. Moving away there, Guy Sieppe Guerini. Ulrich remaining with one strong teammate, Andreas Klöden. But Ulrich, you see, has always got a yellow shadow. That is Lance Armstrong right on his tail. And Kivilev is still in this group now.
What a great Tour de France we're watching here. This man in white uses his team, and he's left alone now because Klöden has gone as well. So again, Ulrich has destroyed his team. It's up to him. We've still got the finishing climb to come. It's back to the original players now. Ulrich on the front. This time Armstrong follows him in yellow.
Armstrong has a teammate. You see the little blue jersey coming across there onto the tail of what is now a three-man chasing group. That is Roberto Heras. The leading group now are 1 kilometre away from the summit. There's just four men. Ertz is there, Belli, Montgomery and Moncoutier. About 30 seconds behind is Bobby Julik, but the big chase is now coming on from the heads of state, the men who have been the toughest men in this Tour de France, Armstrong and Ulrich, and it looks as if Heras has popped off the back of Armstrong. These two men are head and shoulders above everybody else in the Tour.
Well, Ulrich just looks over every time. He looks at Lance Armstrong. He wants to know, too, where Francois Simon is. Well, he's gone now. And Jan Ulrich is climbing up to be second in the Tour de France. He now wants the scalp of Andrei Kivalev. That's who he's looking at. He expects to see Armstrong when he looks round, because Armstrong is always there. He won't let this man out of his sight. He believes he is just too good. And we were talking this morning, Paul, weren't we? If Armstrong wasn't riding this Tour de France, we would be saying we are seeing the finest Jan Ulrich we have ever seen.
Ulrich has been absolutely fantastic. He's done everything possible to bring himself to this Tour de France in great shape. He is in great shape. He's a strong bike rider. We've seen him absolutely formidable in the mountains, but there's one man better than him, and that's Lance Armstrong. If it wasn't for Armstrong, then this man would be certainly the toughest man in the bike race. But because of this, we're seeing a huge battle. They've caught the riders in front of them. There is Lysecker. That is a remarkable comeback. Sastre is the Once rider in the group, and on the front of them, setting the tempo, Stefano Garcia. Zelli probably doesn't even know that the heads of state, Armstrong and Ulrich, are right on his tail.
The top two of last year's Tour de France are right in amongst the leaders now. They've still got to get up to Belliard, Moncoutier, Montgomery and Bobby Julich, but they're not very far behind as they eat up the road beneath clear blue skies on the Col du Tourmalet, and a massive crowd that's camped here, even on the chilly nights, to watch them come through. Garzelli setting the tempo with Cardenas, and behind is Jan Ulrich. He's about to move through on the inside of Garzelli, I think. Here they are. There's only four. Well, there might be five left at the moment. Garzelli sets the pace. It won't be quick enough for Jan Ulrich.
Been great to see Garzelli fight through the mountains, though. We saw him have to pull out of the Giro d'Italia earlier this year with bronchitis, and still he's setting a pretty impressive tempo on the front. Ulrich will be happy right now. He's got Armstrong with him as we come closer and closer to the summit. They're getting rid of all their major rivals, and Armstrong today, I think, will form an allegiance with Jan Ulrich on the final climb of the day. As Ulrich, you're right, he can't go fast enough. He blows away Garzelli, and Armstrong just has to keep that concentrated look on his face and stay in contact with the German.
That was a double take by Garzelli. He took one look and saw Ulrich. He looked again to make sure, and then he realized this is going to be the move of the day. Remember, this really is the final chance for Ulrich to get good time over his nearest rivals, two of whom are still in front of him on the overall. He'll probably take some time out of them in the time trial, but you can't be sure. Today he wants all the time necessary to get into the second place in the Tour de France. This is Montgomery. We're back with the leaders. Montgomery's 181. Best place to the front group. Mario Ertz is the rider in red. They are coming to the top of the Col du Tourmalet, and I hope we get to see the lovely new statue of the man who took over from the founder of the Tour de France, Jacques Godet, who did 52 tours and was a gentleman. But as we see now, Montgomery sprints away for the points of the day. He's going to put down in his buck, I was first over the Tourmalet, followed there by, I think it's Belly, and then Moncoutier.
Jan Ulrich now setting the pace in the Lance Armstrong group. Armstrong very comfortably in second position. Behind him is Garzelli. They have the orange jersey of the Euskaltel Euskadi rider, Roberto Lysecker. He is a man they need to be very careful of later on the climb, because he is the man who actually rode up to these two riders on the summit of the Plateau de Bon Sacre. He came from absolutely nowhere and leapt away from Armstrong Ulrich as they were fighting out for the overall supremacy of this bike race. You can see now Garzelli's accelerated towards the summit. He wants to lead these two men over the top. Well, we will now be treated to a very rapid descent off the summit of this Col du Tourmalet. And look at this time gap. A few moments ago, we were given 1 minute and 45 seconds. It is now 51 seconds. They will have them in their sights.
There's the dizzy heights of the high spot of the Tour de France, the Col du Tourmalet. And how bizarre it is, a sporting event, the crowd are cheering in the absolute middle of nowhere, tens of thousands of people enjoying at first hand the battle amongst the greatest athletes in the world. They come over the top of the climb now, and they begin an equally long, twisting descent to the bottom on narrow roads at first as they hairpin their way down. Very often this mountain at this time of the year is shrouded in mist, and you just watch for the riders coming at you out of the cloud. But today, conditions are perfect as they now begin the long descent down to the bottom, and then they'll start doing it all over again as they go to Luzardi Den. 50 seconds.
It's not very much on a descent like this, and if you do take risks, you will very shortly find that this whole race will come back together, and a big group of around about 15-20 riders will commence the Luzarde Den climb all together. In the second group of chasers on the road is Roberto Heras, Lance Armstrong's faithful lieutenant. He was brought in here to look after Armstrong through the mountains, and he did a great job yesterday. The four men at the front are making an unbelievable descent off this mountain. You can see just how hot it's been. The surface of this descent is really starting to melt now. It's very dangerous in the corners, but one man has slipped away off the front, and it's a red jersey. I would say that's Mario Arts, trying to steal a lead over the rest on this descent.
Well, he's going to take a chance and steal a march if he can. We're going to go down with our camera bike. Can never say often much how much I admire these camera bikes as they follow the riders down the mountain, and how steady they held the camera yesterday when, despite the fact they were watching a rider go off the side, Jan Ulrich, and they followed him and kept him in shot all of the way. Thank heavens he came back to the road, and then Lance Armstrong waited for him, and they continued to the finish together and attacked each other on the final climb. So this is the sort of hill at the moment where you can hit those dizzy speeds of 100 kilometers an hour, and then you hope you can break down for the hairpin bends which follow as you drop down off the Col du Tourmalet. Four riders, we're looking at Jan Ulrich, and thankfully he's on the road this time, because he's not the best of descenders, and he's probably the one that knows that the most.
Just keeping a close eye there to see if I could spot a yellow jersey. This is rather strange to see this man really going on the descent. Armstrong is there, sixth position there behind Jan Ulrich. Ulrich obviously not wanting to attack on the descent just now. And Armstrong, of course, Phil, has got absolutely no need to make any risks at all. Going off the front of the group, one man who does want to take a few risks was Stefano Garzelli. And this now is a long 19-kilometre descent, a very technical descent. And the strange thing about these descents is it doesn't necessarily be good for the riders, because although you're going downhill for around about 25 minutes, it tends to make the muscles get rather cold after a very hard effort they've been through on the ascent up the other side. And then when you come down into the town below, you've got to start that energy again as you kick up towards the finishing line.
Well, flat out, we're going down the climb at the moment. I think we've got behind Bobby Julek here as they gently make their way down. They're well clear of a race which is now spread out again all over the Pyrenees. Many of the riders just getting together now to form the autobus, as they call it, to just get home to the finish and beat the elimination time. But this is the action end of the descent today. And as we go down the mountain, over the top of the climb, the first man was Sven Montgomery, followed by Vladimir Belli, David Moncoutier, Mario Ertz. Then came Bobby Julek 40 seconds later, Stefano Garzelli just 10 seconds behind him, and with him was Ulrich and Armstrong, amongst a couple of others. And we're now on the way down. This is a descent which will take what, Paul? 20 minutes, 25 minutes?
20 to 25 minutes. It's actually on the opposite side of this col, the Col du Tourmalet, that Sean Yates recorded one of the fastest times he'd ever been downhill. 72 miles an hour he had recorded on his computer at the end of the day, and that is absolutely remarkable. It was in a straight line, I hasten to add, but Yates was an absolutely mad descender going down these mountains. He went down as if he was on a motorbike, getting his knee right out. You can see Ulrich doesn't want to lose that bottle right now, but he wants to keep himself topped up with fluids for as long as possible.
It's not easy, because he needs both his hands on for these corners to apply, first of all, gently the front brake, and then check it with the back brake so he doesn't go flying over the handlebars. Here's Lance Armstrong. I think he's trying to take a bit of food out of his back pocket as well, while keeping an eye on things. It is such a hazardous thing coming down these mountains. They are hitting speeds between 80 and 100 kilometres an hour. And as you can see, there's not much protection on the right. A point to remember, by the way, if you ever tour in the Pyrenees on a bike, you remember that the roads aren't closed when you do it, not like they are now. The Tour de France closes its roads for up to 8 hours for its passage, and the organisation never ceases to astound me, and yet they still make sure that people can get to see their race. This is the champion of Germany now, and what a champion he's been on this year's Tour de France. He has refused to accept that Armstrong is going to win this tour.
Interesting to note here that Armstrong's keeping himself full of food there. He's remembering the last mountain stage of the Tour de France last year on the Col de Juplan, when, because of the fact that he felt very nervous chasing after a big breakaway of Marco Pantani, he forgot to eat and he hit the wall. He went into glucose exhaustion and lost 2.5 minutes on the final climb of the Tour de France last year to Jan Ulrich. Today, he's not making that mistake.
These are the three leaders. Having a bite to eat at the back is Mario Ertz. In the middle is David Moncoutier. And off goes the bottle. And at the front there is Vladimir Belli. And for me, Belli is the man who could win this stage.
Well, he's a great climber. We've seen him finish high up in the overall standings at the Giro. He was lying third overall. And somebody's leaping off the front of the Armstrong group right now, hoping that Ulrich and Armstrong mark each other. And this man, he hopes, can ride across the gap. In the middle of the gap right now, by the way, is a man we're forgetting about, Sven Montgomery. He's 20 seconds behind the three leaders, and he is hoping that he will recover and manage to rejoin the group to make it four. It's one of the Benesto riders coming off the front.
I think it's Denis Menchov who's gone. We'll catch a glimpse when he comes up to the camera, if he can catch us. He's made quite a big move there, and again, you see no reaction directly from Armstrong or Ulrich, but Garzelli's trying to come with him here. And there is the field all chasing him down. But this is a good move. He's trying to get away before they start the climb. And he's making full use of the last couple of kilometres of the descent of the Tourmalet.
One man who does want to get away before the ascent of the final climb, in fact, is Stefano Garzelli, the balding figure there of the Mappe rider, coming straight to the front. He sees he's got a gap, and you can see they are now 1 minute and 3 seconds behind the leading group of three. A good move by iBanesto.com to try and get off the front, because certainly, Phil, Armstrong and Ulrich will mark each other, and they will ride up this mountain as hard as they can. For Ulrich, he has to try and put time between himself and Andrei Kivilev. Kivilev starts the day in second place in the overall standings, and he has a mission in this Tour de France now, and that is to stay on the podium.
There's Axel Merckx into a move here, champion of France, Rousse. And there is Lance Armstrong, just trying to catch a glimpse here of Andrei Kivilev, just to convince us that he has come up to this group. There's a little hello mum, says Axel Merckx. He's married to a North American lady, by the way, and speaks both languages fluently. Continues the descent, and something like 13, 14 riders getting themselves back together, and despite that attack there with Garzelli and Menchov up at front. Sun very high in the sky now as we head up to 20 minutes to 5 in the evening in the Pyrenees. Still extremely hot. The good news for the riders, for the last 150 metres of the Luzardi Den climb, they'll have a tailwind. Although I don't suppose they'll notice it. The gradient is so steep.
I don't think that's going to help very much at all, Phil, when you bear in mind these guys are only going to average around about 12 miles an hour for the last 13 kilometres. Not fast at all up the slopes of this huge mountain. They're not too far away now from the town of Luz-Saint-Sauveur, and that is where they will then ride across the town square, which is the flattest part of this part of the course right now, because then immediately it tilts up towards the skies. And they will face and see a banner indicating 13.5 kilometres to the summit, and the summit is a long way above the valley below. They will climb up to 1,715 metres. That's only 100 metres short of Alpe d'Huez.
And the climb, once we go through the town, which has been en fête for a number of days now, beautiful little town, snuggling underneath the climb to Luzardidon and on the opposite valley to Cauterets, where Miguel Indurain won a stage of the Tour de France before he started the first of his five wins overall. Very famous area of the Tour de France is the Pyrenees. These are the men trying to get onto the slopes first as they make their way now towards the climb of Luzardidon. Mario Ertz got a good chance here. The Spanish flags, they're all Spanish flags, these, from the region of the Basque nation. This is Sven Montgomery, who can tick off this Tour de France as winner of the climb over the top of the Col du Tourmalet, where he wins a special prize in memory of Jacques Godet. And he continues too to keep the pressure on. He's had an excellent tour, and so far all of his team continue on the road to Paris. Fourth place for him just now.
He's had a hard time staying in contact on the descent for the moment. You can see the group of three riders just in front of him right now, and he will hope to try and reintegrate them before the start of the climb. the group of Lance Armstrong again slipping further back. He's a minute 15 seconds behind the three leaders, and there's been a small attack coming across from that group of Armstrong. Oscar Sevilla, the leader of the white jersey competition, he too would like to try and get himself a podium position in Paris at the end of this three-week bike race. There is, Phil, going to be a major showdown on the slopes of this climb. Coming off the front of the group, the champion of France, Didier Rousse. He's riding really high in the overall standings after having had a magnificent season. He lies 12th at the start of the day, 21 minutes behind Armstrong. But I think the big heads of state, once the road ticks up towards Luz-Ardiden, they'll come out and blow the race to pieces.
The prize, by the way, for Sven Montgomery on the top of the Col du Tourmalet was $3,500. And that was worth picking up, wasn't it? That's about 2,000 English pounds sterling. So he did well to pick that up, and he's fourth on the road now. A minute and 11 back to the Armstrong group as Rousse tries to get away. But here's Bobby Julich sitting here in the Armstrong group now. Very select bunch of riders as we start the slope. It takes a little while to warm up the climb to Luz-Ardiden, but then it starts, and it starts kicking up in hairpin bends.
It's always very difficult coming off the slopes of a long descent because you really find that the muscles start to cool down a bit. In front of Armstrong, you can see Botera, the man who won the King of the Mountains competition last year. He doesn't want to make excuses, but he's claiming at the moment that he's not riding at the top of his form because of a slight cold that's taken hold of his chest. Didier Rousse, around about 20 seconds off the front of the Armstrong group, but very shortly, the whole of the contenders of the Tour de France will be coming onto the slopes of the last climb of the Tour. Luz-Ardiden.
Massive crowd again as they start to climb away from Luz-Saint-Sever. There's part of the village here, the Pont Napoleon. A stunning picture that is, the Tour de France races high above the river. And a long gap forming now, but we're looking back to about a minute and 15 seconds to the Armstrong group. Here they are. They are in a perfect position. Garzelli has got back to give it, Guerini rather, has got back here to give his man, Jan Ulrich, a handout once more for as long as possible. Ulrich again content to drive this train at the front. A magnificent athlete in his best form, I think. And the book for Lance Armstrong that would have walked away with this year's Tour de France. This is a nice select little group as the tempo once more is picked up. I doubt very much, Paul, whether any of those riders up front can hold this man off.
I don't think so. It's going to be a huge battle here. Armstrong's looking very good in a tactical sense right now because his two teammates, the two Spanish riders, are in this group with him. Right on his tail there is Rubiera, and behind him is Roberto Heras. In fact, Rousse is about 55 seconds behind, so Armstrong's group is moving closer all of the time. Guerini is trying to set up something for his man Jan Ulrich. He will ride as hard as he can until the bottom first kilometer of the climb up to Luz-Ardiden, and then I think he'll let Big Jan take over.
1:15 to this group here as they cross over the Pont Napoleon. 18 riders are in it, so quite a few, about five or six actually got back on the descent of the Col du Tourmalet. Meanwhile, back at the front, these are the three escapers. They've got away on the top of the Col du Tourmalet, made the best descent. Now they are scampering, making their rush for the finish. Mario Ert, Vladimir Obeli, and David Moncoutier. This would be a considerable coup, too, for number 77, Moncoutier. It's not been a great tour for Cofidis, but they're hoping for a high finish with Kivilev, although we have not received convincing arguments that Kivilev is actually in that group. Paul is convinced, though, right?
Kivilev is in that group with Armstrong and Ulrich for the moment, but I do think he won't be by the time we get to the summit of this final climb of the day. These three riders now, Phil, have gone past the banner, indicating they've got 13 kilometres to go to the summit, and they were thinking now about the possibility of an attack. David Moncoutier on the front for Cofidis is a great bike rider who, for France, has a superb future, and they think this man could, later in his career, finish in the top five at the Tour de France. But alongside him is a very experienced man in the shape of Abelli.
It'll take about half an hour to climb now to the finishing line, just 13 kilometres left to ride. This is the champion of France, inspired by that maillot jersey he's pulled on here as champion a week before the tour started, Didier Rousse. The Bonjour team also heading to Paris with their full complement of nine riders. He's trying desperately now to get on to the three frontrunners, leaving a group of 18, which includes Lance Armstrong, Andrei Kivilev, Balocki, Jan Ulrich, but not Francois Simon.
quite a long way behind these riders at the moment. Phil, he's a minute off the leading group of three, but he's putting a fantastic performance in here on the final climb of the day. It's a 13-kilometre climb after what's been a very long, hard day in the saddle for these bike riders. 144 kilometres leaving Tarbes this morning before they get here to the summit of Lou d'Ardiden. But they went over the highest spot of the tour today, 2,115 metres, the Col de Tourmalet, the summit of the tour this year. The magnificent beast, and this is what they've all come over right now, and they're facing the last difficult climb, about 12 kilometres to go for the summit for the three leaders. They have a 25-second advantage over Sven Montgomery. Didier Roos is at 1 minute, and the Lance Armstrong, Jan Ulrich, Roberto Heras group is a minute 16 back, but shortly that group will accelerate.
Well, Vladimir Belli, the Italian, he's if these three stay towards the top, he's the man I feel will win. He'll plan an attack somewhere if he's got the legs today, and he looks as though he might have. He looks pretty good. Had two very good results. No wins this season, by the way, for Vladimir Belli, but he's had third in the Tour of Switzerland and third in the Tour of Romandy. Romandy is also one of the cantons of Switzerland, and two very good races to finish well up in.
And he was third overall in the Tour of Italy until a few days to go, until he got eliminated from the race from a very good knock on the nose to Gilberto Simoni's nephew.
Great shot though, whatever you say, but I was sorry they disqualified him for it. And even the man on the receiving end on that occasion, by the way, Simoni's nephew, did think the decision was a bit harsh because he said he deserved it. Well, there you go, that's life. Here we are now with Guerini on the front, still going to sacrifice himself in one or two more kilometres time, and then are we going to see Jan Ulrich just rip the race apart again and tow only Armstrong with him? Because when he goes, Lance Armstrong is the only man who can hook up and go.
It's being set up perfectly right now. You can see on the front the pink jersey of the man who leads him, Giuseppe Guerini, a winner at Alpe d'Huez, will ride as hard as he can until he has no more in his legs. He will then swing off and leave all of the pacemaking up to his team leader. His team leader, Jan Ulrich, will then try and blow everybody off his wheel. This is a bit further down the slope right now. At the back of the group, Axel Merckx, the former champion of Belgium, looking very good. All of the dangerous Onse riders are in this group, but the pace is unbelievable right now. Guerini is doing an incredible job for Jan Ulrich, and as we get closer to the summit, surely Big Jan will take over.
This is Guerini. Incredible pacemaking here, and it looks as though Lance has got one rider with him now. It's probably Rubiera who's come back up to him, I think, as we go up to the three leaders. The crowd dense here now as we start to get on to the serious bit of Lou d'Ardiden. A climb which, again, has been won by the big names of this sport. And Belli, Ertz and Moncoutier have stolen a march. But somehow I don't feel as though they can stay away to the finish. The first man to win on this climb was none other than Miguel Indurain, but Dagoto Lauritsen, Norwegian riding on the American 7-11 team, also won on this climb too.
And a man sitting not too far away from us here, commentating for Spanish television, one at the summit here as well, Perico Delgado. And there are a lot of Perico Delgado supporters out here on the course at the moment. And although he now works for television, he's still as popular as he ever was as a bike rider. This is a great move by Didier Roos, the leader of the Bonjour team, one of the only teams left in the bike race with a full complement of nine riders. Alongside them, the Française des Jeux. And this will be a remarkable coup for Jean-René Bernadeau, the team manager here. And in fact, you can see they're clearing everything away right now, because this man is certainly going to get caught rather shortly by the accelerations of Armstrong, Ulrich and the rest.
And here they come. Guerini still giving 110% as the other riders queue up now behind him to take the lead, and they attack.
This is Lyseka from Euskaltel Euskadi. He wants to get the win right now. These riders want to win. They're probably, as the crow flies, Phil, not more than 3 kilometres away from the Spanish border. If we could walk straight up to the top, we'd roll down the other side into Spain. The Spaniards are absolutely on fire on this day today. They want to win the stage and they want to take the glory. They regard the Pyrenees almost as home turf, which is why Lyseka has come out of the group. But in fact, it's interesting to note that Ulrich, for the moment, hasn't been able to respond.
Well, Lyseka has gone, gambling on the fact they're not going to chase him down yet. He's got a lot of lost time to make up, and they're not worried about him. Ulrich just looks to see the whereabouts of Lance. He's never, ever very far away from him. But Ulrich also concerned about the whereabouts of Kivalev. I'm yet to see Kivalev in this group, and I'm not convinced he's here.
Guerini setting the pace at the front, still waiting for the moment when Lance Armstrong and Jan Ulrich accelerate past him. Then he will know his job is done for the day. We've just got a glimpse there of the Cofidis rider. The number on his back was number 74. That is Andrei Kivalev.
Just tucked into the back, and that is the man that Armstrong is constantly looking around for, because he wants to rid himself of Kivalev to claim second overall. And Kivalev every day is becoming stronger and stronger. Watch for 74, there he is. He is riding better and better every day. This is a man who was sailing away to an anonymous finish in the Tour de France, got into a breakaway which gained 35 minutes, and now he's decided he wants a podium place in Paris. And every day, Paul, he just gets better.
Well, he's feeling more and more confident with the fact that he's getting closer to Paris, and this is the final mountain stage. He lost 18 minutes on one stage on the day to Verdun, which, and that day went to Laurent Jalabert, but he came back with an incredible breakaway of 34 minutes over the main field. Ever since then, he's lost it little by little, but he hopes now that he'll survive on the final slopes of this year's Tour de France. Didier Roos is doing a great ride, huge honour, but look at this. The orange jersey coming up here is Roberto Laiseca. We've seen him win a stage of the Vuelta a España. This man is an absolutely brilliant climber. He goes past the Frenchman, and I wonder if the Frenchman's got anything to be able to accelerate and stay on his wheel.
10 kilometres to go. These three have a real chance. It gets harder, believe me, but they have a chance here, and Belli knows it. And this man is sniffing victory as well. Roberto Laiseca is now up and going past a very tired Didier Roos there. The champion of France is slipping steadily back out of the action. This is Sven Montgomery. He's been caught as well now by Laiseca. Laiseca is sensing this is the big one.
Well, this is now why you can see that the Euskaltel-Euskadi team worked with Lance Armstrong's US Postal team earlier in the day. They felt that this man had a brilliant chance of getting himself a victory. He's leaping off the front right now. We've seen him win two stages of the Tour of Spain and finish in sixth place in the overall standings. And now the acceleration coming on the front from Guerini. I think Guerini is almost done at the moment. And you can see Ulrich is being left to do all of the pacemaking himself. Ulrich still has his pilot fish, Guerini, in front of him at the moment, and Armstrong is quite happy to stay there. The brakes are coming right now as we go under 10 kilometres to go for the main field.
Looking down, Lance Armstrong concerned only with the whereabouts of Jan Ulrich, while Roberto Laiseca has flown away over the top of this group and he's carving his way up to the leaders. Now we know why Euskaltel-Euskadi were helping with US Postal on the early part of today. They were trying to set the race up for this man. Here he is. He is galloping up the climb now.
Let's not forget on the first Pyrenean stage, the summit above Axley-Term, Roberto Laiseca caught and left Jan Ulrich and Lance Armstrong. He finished second on the stage on that day. This man is an absolutely remarkable climber. He's an old, experienced professional. He turned pro back in 1994. He's 32 years of age, and he really is looking for this win right now. But he still has got to pull back the leading group of three. Moncoutier is there. In fact, he's not the leading group now because Vladimiro Belli has gone. He's using a huge gear on this climb at the moment. This is a big chance for Belli, a big for revenge for a season which has seen him ejected from the Tour of Italy after a pretty smart punch on the nose to a spectator.
This is the move we expected Belli to make. He's waited till he thought the other two were cooked, and then it was time to give it a shot. He doesn't know that Laiseca is coming up quickly, but if he can just get away, he's got a good chance. Belli has made the sprint now to break the other two. He's got to hang on because the climb gets steeper here. It is a real grind right now, and as you can see, those big thighs are beginning to ache. Massive crowd on this climb too. Well, they can start cheering for an Italian, and the Spanish riders won't like that because they feel this is virtually home ground. Spain is just over the peaks around us, and here's the man who wants to win for Spain and the right part of Spain too, the north of Spain, as Roberto Laiseca goes over the other two, and he said, well, there should have been three, so there must be one round the corner.
He will know there's one man right in front. This is an unbelievable place being set here by Roberto Lysecker. A great chance for him to come to the Tour de France this year as a wild card with the Euskaltel-Euskadi team. And he will know there's one man remaining to be picked off. That is a very experienced professional, Vladimiro Belli. He turned pro back in 1992. He's 30 years of age. And in fact, it's not far away till he reaches his birthday, this young man here. He's had 11 wins in his career, and this would be his greatest. But I don't think, Phil, it's going to happen, because this man Roberto Lysecker is eating up the road.
He's going to have to just live in hope now, because this rider is being cheered on every inch of the way by the Basque people on the roadside. They can speak his language. It's not Spanish they speak. They speak Basque language to each other. It's rather like the Welsh language back home in the British Isles. Nobody outside of the Basque people will understand this language. And he's now set fair here to go for what will be the best win of his life. But he's got to pick up Vladimir Belli. Meanwhile, back in the peloton with the heads, there's about 11 of them left. Still Guerini looking after Ulrich. No attack on the horizon yet.
Ulrich doesn't look as if he's in great shape right now. In fact, he's quite happy to stay alongside his teammate here, Guerini. Guerini working very hard. These men just want to do one thing, and that is get rid of Andrei Kivilev, because in the overall standings at the start of the day, Armstrong led Kivilev by 3 minutes 54 seconds, and Francois Simon, who has disappeared from the group right now. So Ulrich would be moving into third place on the road at the moment, but he still needs to get rid of number 74. Not one man in this group would be worried at all about Roberto Lysecker, because he's 33rd in the overall standings, and he is 55 minutes behind. Armstrong now, Phil, has decided to take up responsibility of the chase, and he's sent his men to the front to really lift this pace and put the hammer down once again.
Well, Andrei Kivilev is a minute and 19 seconds superior to Jan Ulrich, and Jan won't be happy with that for the time trial. He needed time out of him today. Kivilev is proving very obstinate and is in that group. Here comes the leader of the Kelme team, Botero, just about to hook onto the back of this group, but Kivilev is having the ride of his life.
Kivilev is just hoping to hang on, but even if Jan Ulrich goes over him, he should stay in a podium position. This is the lone leader right now, and he doesn't have much more than 10 seconds advantage over Roberto Lysecker. Lysecker can almost see the Italian in front of him, and slowly but surely he will drag himself up to his slipstream. But watch out for the Italian. He's a very experienced man. He's finished high in the overall standings of many great races. He's finished 12th in the Giro and 8th, and this year was lying third overall until he was ejected from the event. Roberto Lysecker looking up the long straight right now, can see just in the distance the white jersey of Vladimiro Belli. In the group behind, it's Jose Luis Rubiera who's come to the front for Lance Armstrong to pick up the pacemaking, and Armstrong now has decided to finish off this bike race as he started it. Going off the back, one of the riders from Euskaltel-Euskadi, Inigo Charro. And again, the pacemaking on the front by Lance Armstrong's team is absolutely to perfection. That is Rubiera on the front. In fifth position is Roberto Heras. And I would think right now Jan Ulrich will be breathing a sigh of relief. His teammates disappearing from the group one by one.
As Rubiera takes up now the pacemaking for Armstrong, this group is just going off the back one by one. The latest man in trouble is Carlos Sastre for Once. The Locky is still here, trying to make it the same result as a year ago in Paris. 1-2-3. But I'm not so sure, because Andrei Kivilev now is beginning to look quite an obstinate character. The Kazakhstan rider is still there. This rider is still in the lead, but only just at 7.8 kilometers to go to the finish. And when you look over your shoulder, that's usually a sign you're not feeling too good. And Vladimir Belli is still a long way to climb, and this doesn't get any easier. Here comes the Express from Spain on his way up, and he's got Belli in his sights now. And if he gets up there, I think he won't even give him a chance for a deep breath. He'll go straight by him.
Don't discount Vladimiro Belli. He's actually been sitting up for the last 500 metres or so, and he's waiting for this man to come up to him. Considering Roberto Lysecker is riding exceptionally well just now, he's having a hard time pulling back Vladimiro Belli. And I think if we get caught on the flatter part of the course, Belli may still have enough energy in those legs to stay in contact with the flying Basque.
This is his big moment now, his first Tour de France for Lysecker. He's coming up on the very last climb of the Pyrenees to an Italian who is a very good climber. But you can almost sense this man is building up a sprint to go by him. Belly, the tempo is hurting because he's been out in the lead for so long today. But Lysekka, who appeared in trouble on the mountains out in the interior, has just become like two men here now as he comes up to the finish of Luzardiden. It is still a nasty way up to the summit, and you can see the top eventually from an awful long way down. And the reason you can see the top is because the whole route is zigzagged by people.
It's so nasty when you're halfway up a climb and you just tilt your head upwards and you can see a whole line of cars and people waiting to welcome you. As a non-climber, that's not the greatest sight in the world, but for these men, this is their terrain, this is what they love. The junction has now been made. Vladimiro Belli has been joined by Roberto Lysekka, but just watch out, there's the attack. This is the moment, and in fact Belli hasn't got anything at all to answer. He waited to see if the Italian had any power left in those legs, and he doesn't. One lone leader now, but look out, Phil. Belli is not going to give up that easily. He wants the big win. And here now is the group of Armstrong. They're about to catch Didier Roos and Sven Montgomery.
These two have hit the wall after being great. Now the Basques have got their flags above their man, as their man now is going to be drawn to the summit by the attraction of all of his friends waiting to cheer him on. But Belli, hats off, he has lifted his pace and he is staying with him. Now that is a great bike rider.
When you've been professional for a long time like Belli, you know how to react when you get caught on a climb, and Belli is no fool when it comes to climbing. If you finish in the top 10 in the Giro d'Italia, then you know how to handle yourself in the big mountains. But the accelerations of Lysekka are absolutely remarkable. This man is a beautiful climber, and he will be hoping to crown it at the summit of this climb today at Luzardiden, because looking out from the commentary position, there are so many Basque flags out here, and they would love the team in orange to win. And in fact, I have never seen so many orange t-shirts at the side of the road. They've got a huge supporters club, this small team from the Basque land.
Well, Rubiera, who seemed to be struggling in the first 8 days of this Tour de France, always in the back groups, was obviously saving himself for the mountains, setting a pace alongside his team captain Lance Armstrong at the front. Magnificent now, as they're picking off the riders who are in the breakaways one by one and putting them back in the place. The sensation of the day is doubtlessly Andrei Kivilev, because he's in second place. He's not conceding a single second of his lead at the moment, of his second place lead, that is. Francois Simon has gone, will probably drop out of third. Up will come Jan Ulrich into third, Balocki into fourth. But they're all going to look and say, well, what do we do about Kivilev?
Well, Kivilev is still hanging in there at the moment. He's riding an absolutely exceptional race. He's got stronger mentally over the last 2 days, and I think he's hoping now to stay in front of Ulrich on this stage, but certainly Ulrich must pass him in the individual time trial towards the end. But for Kivilev, his goal is to get into the top three in Paris. 6.5 kilometers to go for Roberto Lysekka, who is now completely on his own in the lead. Around about 20 seconds behind him is Vladimiro Belli. This man must now concentrate and make a lone furrow all the way to the summit of this very long 14-kilometer ascent to Luzardiden.
As we look at Vladimiro Belli here trying desperately to control a flying Basque, we are hearing that Cardenas has been dropped by the chase group now. So Armstrong's group at 1 minute 17 has left behind the Felix Cardenas, the winner of 2 days ago. He's still feeling very tired, but he is a very young man. Rubiera setting the pace now for Lance Armstrong. Ulrich, with no teammates left around him, forced into position number three. Armstrong just holding his tempo, and if Ulrich doesn't attack, I don't think Lance Armstrong will either. This is Mario Ertz here, who's slowly slipping back and out of it now. He was up there. Vladimiro Belli is still in the lead. Felix Cardenas has just been dropped. Gardzelli looks to be in a spot of trouble now as well, as the riders now go up to the front. And still in the lead is Roberto Lysekka. And Andrei Kivilev, there he is, he's doing the ride of his life there, number 74. He is holding his second place overall. And what's more, he predicted he would in the newspapers this morning. And he says, yes, of course, the podium is a real possibility for me in Paris.
With this ride today, his possibility of staying on the podium is really looking better as the kilometres tick by. It looks as if Ulrich is not as strong as he was on the previous day in the mountain, but he is a man who has absolutely attacked the mountains to try and put Armstrong into difficulty. No other man has attempted to do that, but Kivilev right now, Phil, is in difficulty. Didier Roos has let the gap go. There is Kivilev. His teammate Moncoutier coming up alongside is going to try and pace him him onto the tail of Jan Ulrich's group.
This will not be easy. Moncoutier himself is tired, but he's probably gone up and said, Andre, follow me, you've got to try. You mustn't crack now because you are close to staying second. Remember that Ulrich must get to the finishing line a minute and 16 seconds ahead of Kivilev to take away his second place overall. This, the last day of the high mountain to the Tour de France. After that, they will shadow box and then they will try to finish it off in the time trial. Kivilev can't afford to concede virtually any of his lead today, and the gap is opening, the door is opening. Moncoutier hasn't in fact waited for him, he's gone and joined the leaders, but he should.
He should drop back and pace his teammate up here, although Moncoutier would like to ride high in the overall standings himself. He's a long way back, he should drop back now, and he is doing. This is the good work of a teammate. He will try and pace his teammate to keep him as close as possible to Jan Ulrich, because for Cofidis, a team that had every man in the group 18 minutes behind on the road to Verdun, has pulled themselves back up to the possibility of a podium finish. Of all the top riders, Phil, in the Tour de France overall standings right now, there is only one man missing from that yellow jersey group of Lance Armstrong, and that is the man who wore the yellow jersey up until today, Francois Simon. But this man at the front is absolutely burning up the road. A great move by him, and the orange jersey of the Basque supporters will go absolutely potty. There's the Basque flag flying high.
A minute and 15 seconds to the leader from this group here at the moment. Now, if Ulrich senses that he's got Kivilev in trouble, and I think I agree with Paul, he's not having the best of days right now, but I feel convinced that in the last kilometre or so, Ulrich will attack to take more time. That will cause Armstrong to attack, and that should, in distance, poor Andre Kivilev, who is still struggling behind with his teammate helping him, and Carlos Sastre of Once sitting behind the two of them, and hoping they'll get him back up to this group as well. These are the wheels, or the frame, of the man now in the lead today, Lysecka, 32 years of age, won only four races, but he chooses his great wins, finished sixth in the Tour of Spain last year, and won a stage of the Vuelta, and he's done that twice.
He's a good rider, and all of his major victories have been in the mountains, and he rode superbly in the mountains in the Vuelta a España last year, and this is his first attempt at the Tour de France, and if he can just hold on, this will be the greatest victory of his career, making a total of five. But as you say, if you're going to win races, you might as well make them big ones. Vladimiro Belli is at the moment around about 10 seconds behind, and it's a minute 15 back to the Lance Armstrong group, and still just hanging off the back of that group is Andrei Kivilev, trying and hoping he can stay in contact. Armstrong now has two teammates in front of him pacing him, Roberto Heras going forward. This is why the US Postal Service signed up these Spanish riders during the winter months. They knew that Armstrong was vulnerable in the mountains, and they are now today earning their keep.
Well, I don't know how Roberto Heras does it. One minute he's hanging on, the next minute he forces himself up to Lance Armstrong and gives everything. There he is on the front now, taking over from Rubiera. And as we've seen so often, Ulrich and his team start the trouble, and Lance Armstrong and his survivors finish it all off. Vladimir Belli is having big trouble of his own right now, as he continues to climb here in second place at Lutzardi-Denne, and we are 4.9 kilometres from the finish. Can Kivilev hold on to this one?
It looks as if Kivilev is just struggling back there. You can see he's there with his teammate, and he's doing everything that he can to stay in contact. He knows he only has to do it for one more day. There's a long, hard road up through the centre of France from now on, and Kivilev has to stay there. He's being helped remarkably there by his teammate. Moncoutier will give him words of encouragement at the moment, and he will try and pace him and keep him comfortable. At the moment, though, at the front of the bike race, Lysecka is doing a magnificent ride for one of the smallest teams in the Tour de France, Euskaltel Euskadi, and for them to get the victory here would be great. He's already finished second on a mountain stage. That was a couple of days ago to the Plateau de Bonsacre, just above Aix-les-Thermes. And on that situation, it was in fact the Colombian rider Felix Cardenas who got the win.
Under the 5 kilometre to go banner there, 3 miles from the top for the group led by Heras, Rubiera, Armstrong, Ulrich. This is Didier Roust now, the champion of France, paying the price of the attack at the bottom of the climb as he slips backwards a little bit. It is such a long way to the top when you are tired. 4.6 kilometres to go now for the leader on the day, Lysecka. But I'm not too sure whether Kivilev will survive.
Well, Kivilova's got to dig so deep right now to try and stay in contention, because he is just hoping that he can keep himself in a position to climb onto the podium in Paris. And that would be a great comeback for the Cofidis team after what has been a very difficult start to the event for them. Rijsselaer, though, for the moment, Phil, is opening up his advantage over the group of Lance Armstrong. The last time check we had was a minute and 20 seconds. But if you look up there towards the summit of the skies, he's still got a very long way to climb. We're just in the cradle of those mountains right now, waiting for the man from the Basque land to arrive, and it's going to take him around about 15 minutes to get here to the finish.
This is the section I was telling you about, where you can see the top because of the crowd lines, all of the cars lined up there, pulled off the road, and this now zigzags all up the mountain to the summit of Lusardi-Den. But Lysecker, although under pressure, he's not a tiring man yet, and he's inspired by the home crowds who are cheering him all of the way up the climb today. He's gapped 17 seconds on Belly, 1:15 still on the group Armstrong.
Well, Belly now is just trying to survive, Phil, and hoping he can stay off the front of the Armstrong group. But Armstrong is being piloted by two very strong Spanish climbers on his own team, Roberto Jerez and Jose Luis Rubiera. In that group, Jan Ulrich is just hoping and praying that Andrei Kivilev is going to crack, and he's going to finish the day in second place in the overall standings. But it's still going to be a big battle for the German.
He's looking now for the 4 kilometers to go banner, and the Spanish crowd are beside themselves. This is the one they were waiting for. The Spanish riders weren't going to let them down. Just inside 4 kilometers to go now for Roberto Lysecker, and they will cheer him all of the way to the summit, and he will see the summit now from where he actually is, because the people there can watch him snake his way up.
3 kilometers to go, and he's 30 seconds ahead of Vladimiro Belli right now. And if anyone is going to get lifted by the crowds, he's really going to do it now. The crowd are all behind this man. They're waving their flags to try and push him up towards the finish line. There is the group of Ulrich, and Kivilev is no longer there right now. Ulrich and Armstrong. Armstrong moving up alongside the tail of Roberto Jerez. You can see Rubiera has done his job, but Ulrich today is being very attentive. The white jersey of Oscar Sevilla is also starting to crack, and so is Josiba Beloki in the pink of Once.
4 kilometers to go for the chase group, while Lysecker heads up to the 3 kilometer banner. This is a real tussle, but he should win now, unless somebody attacks from this group, and the gap will close quickly. And this is the white jersey of Oscar Sevilla, one of the great finds of this year's Tour de France. He wears white because he's a rookie, a first-timer, and he's still a young youth on his side to become a great rider in future years.
Roberto Jerez just now pacing Armstrong as much as possible. He looks over his shoulder to see what sort of damage he's doing to Armstrong's challengers behind. He knows now he's got rid of Joseba Beloki, and he's also got rid of the white jersey leader, that is Oscar Sevilla. But this man is riding a lone race at the front of this huge mountain here, just on the slopes, tipping over towards Spain. He's just hoping he can survive. He's got a huge advantage right now, but in the last couple of kilometers, Phil, it is so easy to crack, and a minute is absolutely nothing.
So Robert Lysecker heading for what he hopes will be the finest win in a few moments' time of his career. No interest in a hunt for the yellow jersey. He's lost too much time over 2,250 kilometers of the Tour de France. There's the 3 kilometer banner ahead of him, and he is looking very, very good indeed now. But this man is climbing steadily. Behind him, Andrei Kivilev, the same cannot be said. He has snapped the elastic and he's going backwards. He must finish no less, and that's assuming Ulrich gets no bonus at the top. 1 minute, 16 seconds after Jan Ulrich to hold his second place overall.
It's a huge battle for this man who attacked at the bottom of the climb, and he's hoping to survive because behind he's got some of the toughest bike riders in the world chasing him. Roberto Jerez for the moment is pacing Lance Armstrong and Jan Ulrich, but for Ulrich, his personal battle today is trying to move up into second place in the overall standings. Josiba Beloki is also hoping that he too can survive, because if Kivilev cracks dramatically, Beloki could be climbing up into a podium position in Paris. This is the second man on the road, Vladimiro Belli. He's doing a magnificent ride, Phil, because he's 23 seconds behind Lysecker at the moment and around about 45 seconds in front of Armstrong and Ulrich.
And look at this now, still the pressure being put on here by Heras. He's about to move over, I think, and they'll launch Armstrong and Ulrich to the summit. They are now just two leaders and one helper. Heras has been superb this past few days. This is Sevilla here, and Bolocki trying to get back on terms, but they are losing time. At least Kivalev will be happy about this. He's not losing quite so much to Bolocki.
Well, Bolocki was hoping that it would be exactly the same podium positions as last year. Last year it was first Armstrong, second Ulrich, third Bolocki. Bolocki at the start of the day was in fifth place overall. I would think by the end of tonight he will be in fourth, because Kivalev for the moment is still hanging on. Heras is also hanging as one on as well. He is working as hard as he can, working his heart out for his leader Lance Armstrong, who still looks as calm and collected as you like. He's riding this race with the absolute domination of men like Eddy Merckx in the past. Whenever he's wanted to accelerate, he has done. I think today the only reason he hasn't accelerated, Phil, is because he feels quite comfortable with his advantage over Ulrich.
There's no reason to chase Roberto Laiseca, so this man is free now with a stunning attack to take the stage win for the Basque country of Spain. As he climbs up now towards the end of what has been a tough day in the saddle for everybody, three in a row, the third mountain top finish. Tomorrow they have another rest day in Pau, and then, unlike many tours, they're riding away from the Pyrenees rather than staying in Pau before they ride into the Pyrenees, because we often think of that great city as the gateway to the high mountains. But this time, they'll turn their backs on the Pyrenees and they'll race up the centre of France, bound for Paris. And this rider has come here for one reason, as to win a big mountain stage of the Tour de France. He's left it late, but he's going to win it now. They're not going to catch him.
They shouldn't catch him at all, because all of the time that gap from him back to Lance Armstrong and Ulrich is totally stable at a minute 15 or a minute 20. Roberto Heras is doing a great job for Armstrong here, and he's also doing a pretty good job for Jan Ulrich as well, who's distancing all of the men behind him in the overall standings. And he, in fact, I think today is going to drag the yellow, the second place position off the shoulders of Andrei Kivalev. And that is what Ulrich wanted at the start of today.
Yes, he didn't want to leave anything to the time trial, although in theory he's a much better time trial rider than Kivalev. He wanted to make sure he was taking second place away from the Pyrenees, where you can see your man and you can beat him if you have the strength. Roberto Heras, superb today, taking the two leaders of the Tour de France to the summit, not just Lance Armstrong, because Ulrich has been great this year. A minute 13, these three now are behind the leader on the road, still locked in the middle and defiant, and there he is at 2 kilometres to go, is Vladimir Belli, this man who's having his best season despite his disqualification in the Giro d'Italia.
Well, he will just hope to survive. He will know exactly what's going on at the side. There is so much communication at the Tour de France this year that with the radios at the side of the road, he will know just exactly what the race format is. He will know there are three riders chasing him, and he will know exactly who they are. The riders that we're looking after, Andrei Kivalev has been left behind right now. He's in a group with Gonzalez de Galdiano. They are hoping to keep themselves in the top 10 of the Tour de France at the moment. But these men that we're looking at, Phil, have been the animators of the mountains. Armstrong and Ulrich, and I tell you what, Heras is riding like a demon today. His knee has been killing him since the start of this Tour de France. He's had constant treatment for it, and he's just hoped he would survive to help Armstrong in the big mountains, which is why he's really riding his heart out right now. He's doing it for one thing, for Armstrong in yellow.
And now Lance goes up on his shoulder, and Ulrich is again in the US postal sandwich here as he continues to climb towards the top. The first five men are now inside 2 kilometres to the finish. Ulrich, to me, looks as though he is now desperately under pressure here. He always rides with this same crouched position, but there's his face for you. He is struggling. It hasn't been his day up here, Paul. I don't think he's had it in him to attack Armstrong anyway.
No, he was hoping to survive today to attack Armstrong, but he put in some magnificent work yesterday, and I think he may not have yet recovered from that. He's not the great man in the mountains. He rides on force in these mountains, and it's difficult to recover. The difference between him and Armstrong is Armstrong rides with a very small gear. And you can see this man here, Roberto Laiseca, an excellent climber from the Basque land, is also climbing with a fairly small gear, and he will be happy right now, because that little blue bridge in the distance will indicate to him he's only got 1,000 meters to go. But you can see where he's going. That 1,000 meters is still a long way upwards towards the sky.
Directly above his right shoulder, in fact, he will hook his way round to the right past those tents, and then he will see the finishing line. A finishing line viewed by the great riders of the Tour de France who have been first up this famous mountain. Just look at the crowd ahead now as he makes his way up to the finish, and the cheers, because this is a hometown crowd for a man who just comes from the other side of the Pyrenees. Those flags, those red flags of the White Cross, are his nation's flags, because the Basque people believe they're not Spanish.
He now has just got to get through the final few corners here to join a long list of very famous Spanish riders who have won up here. Pedro Delgado has won here, as has Miguel Indurain, and soon they will be reading the name of Roberto Laiseca. In fact, Ulrich has attacked, but you know, this is a last-minute attack. You see how easy that was for Armstrong, right onto the tail of the German. But the German, Phil, will not give up until this bike race gets to Paris. That was a great move of defiance by Ulrich. But Armstrong just dances into his slipstream.
It's an attack which I think will give him second place in the Tour de France, even so. But Paul is right. This man doesn't know the word, I'm giving up. He's going for it. Armstrong is not under pressure. He just has answered the attack. I think he probably expected it as well. At 1 kilometre to go now, Ulrich is pulling away from Kivilev. He must get up there. He'll get a small time bonus unless Lance Armstrong goes over the top of him in the sprint, because it's only the first three riders get small time bonuses. But Armstrong doesn't want to continue the attack. If Ulrich doesn't, Armstrong slows.
Armstrong's quite happy today to match Jan Ulrich. He's 5 minutes behind the American in the overall standings, and Armstrong knows that Ulrich wants to pull himself up into second place. He will mark him right the way up to the finishing line, and the fact that he's staying behind him indicates to me that he won't even try to sprint on the line. Armstrong is happy with this, but one man will be even happier with his day on the Tour de France today, and that's Roberto Laiseca.
He's 32, he's Spanish, and he's about to win his first stage of the Tour de France. Roberto Laiseca has done what everybody came here to see, score a home win from the other side of the Pyrenees. He knows now they're not going to catch him. He's just a little bit of a look over his shoulder there to make sure, and another one in case they're sneaking around the inside. But he has about 49 seconds over Vladimir Obeli, who is still just defying Armstrong and Ulrich. This is it now. He can reserve a little wave to his friends, because there's plenty of them out there. And that's why they camped all night on Luzardiden. The flag is Basque. The winner is Basque. The stage town, very much French. Laiseca comes home a winner. He adds this to his two victories in the last two editions of the Tour of Spain.
Absolute magnificent win there. This man won it the way he had to, going out on a long lone attack. He picked off every one of the breakaways in front of him one by one until he finally caught up with this man, Vladimir Obeli, and he then left the poor Italian behind. This man had dreamed of victory. He's had a great season. He will finish second at the summit of Luzardiden, but pretty smartly after he crosses the line, he will see the express train of Armstrong and Ulrich coming up behind him.
Vladimir Belli, almost, is it going to be a smile? I think it might be, because he's been a brilliant rider today. The survivor of the 10 breakaways that went at 45 kilometres as he comes to the top 100 kilometres later. And he is the only one to survive. All of the others have been passed down the mountain. He gets up for second place, a good result for Fassa Bortolo. But once Jan Ulrich hits the line with Armstrong, then the watch will start.
Well, here they are right now. Here is Ulrich, right on his tail is Lance Armstrong as Ulrich accelerates. I don't think Armstrong will do anything at all to try and come by. The two of them finishing locked together, and look at that. A sign of accomplishment for the two riders. I think that was a sign of thank you for letting me get the 10 seconds bonus.
A small bonus, though, indeed. And that means now he only has to finish by just over 1 minute. Heras comes over next. He gets the fifth place finish. Armstrong, fourth, didn't need to go for third today ahead of Jan Ulrich. But the clock has started on the arrival of Ulrich. This is the arrival of Bolocki. He gets sixth with that brilliant little youngster, Oscar Sevilla, finishing in seventh.
Well, Oscar Sevilla taking serious option on winning that competition when we get up to Paris. But hats off to the champion of France as well. He's never been known as a great climber, but he put in a very sporting effort today. He's worked over the last few days for his teammate François Simon, but today he rode for himself. And that ride by Didier Roust today, Phil, might move him into the top 10 in the overall standings at the end of the day. Here's Kivilev.
A desperate sprint for the line, as the clock says, at 57 seconds. It is desperately close, and he's not going to give up, Paul. This is the man coming to the line now. The difference between Ulrich crossing it and Kivilev has just passed as we speak. He has dropped to third in the Tour de France, but we are talking seconds.
Well, we're only talking seconds right now for Andrei Kivalev, but he will still keep himself in a podium position. A great courageous ride by that man over the last kilometre. Quite a remarkable stage we've had up here as we look further down. And this is the man who won a couple of days ago coming up to the line right now. This is quite remarkable, the day we've had on the slopes of Luz Ardiden.
Ulrich started the day 1:19 behind Kivalev and beat him by exactly that amount, which makes the hand he offered Armstrong crossing the finish line all the more significant. Without the 8-second bonus for third place, he'd be tied with the Kazakh rider. As things stand, he's alone in second and likely to stay there. So too is Laurent Jalabert, leading the King of the Mountains competition with no real mountains left. Stuart O'Grady goes into the final week ahead of Erik Zabel in the green jersey points competition. And I think by now, you all know who's in yellow.
So going into the final week, Lance Armstrong was essentially in cruise control with the radio on and the windows rolled down. While he was enjoying the scenery and thinking ahead to the final time trial and a possible fourth stage win, a man who'd been hanging on through the punishment of the Alps and the Pyrenees could start to think about stage wins themselves. The road flattened out and started to head north here to Paris.
To make up for the lack of climbs, though, is the Tour's longest stage at 226 kilometres. A series of early attacks eventually settled into a 25-man break, but with 30 kilometres to go, Marco Pinotti escaped off the front of it. 17 kilometres later, Rick Verbrugge joined him, leaving the 23 behind them, wondering how they managed to let it happen and trying to organise a chase. The main pack, meanwhile, was having a day off, cruising along 15 minutes behind. As Phil Liggett and Paul Sherwin pick it up, Pinotti and Verbrugge are just 10 seconds clear, 2 kilometres to go.
This is going to be a tight finish for these two, because as those kilometres go by, that peloton chasing is going to get pretty excited.
You can see the urgency now in their pedalling style. In fact, that acceleration there coming from Pinotti on the front there put Verbrugge in a bit of difficulty. He managed to recover and get back onto the slipstream, but the Italians are chasing the Italians at the front now. A long turn being done by Tossato. He's got his teammate in this group. This is a man who's tasted glory at the Giro d'Italia, and he's trying to force two lines at the front so this group will organise themselves and try and pull the two leaders back together. It is still coming down. It's come down by a further 5 seconds. It's 10 seconds. It's going to be around about 5 seconds when they see the 1 kilometre to go banner, and if they accelerate over the last 500 metres, it is going to be so close. The gap behind these two riders now has been totally cleared. The neutral service car has been taken away. The red car of the referees has been taken away. And you see these riders are professional. They know that. They're looking back now, Phil, to judge the gap that they have as they come under the banner indicating 1,000 metres to go to the line.
1 kilometre from the finish at the end of 232. And this is touch and go. The spread is a blanket between Verbrugge, Pinotti and the chase here. So many of those riders behind now will sense they have a chance. It's barriered now all the way to the finishing line, over a kilometre. There it is for the peloton as they charge down the home straight now. Pinotti is committed in the front and Verbrugge is waiting to jump him.
Verbrugge was caught inside the last kilometre on the stage into Strasbourg, but I don't think that's going to happen now. These guys are riding so fast, and at the front of the main pack, they're all over the road. They will now start to manoeuvre. On the outside, it's going to be man against man. This is a great way to sprint it out. Two very strong bike riders right now waiting for the last 500 metres. You can see Pinotti is in front position here. Verbrugge looking very concentrated on his wheel. Any moment now, one man must kick.
Verbrugge gambling here and waiting as long as possible. He won't know how well Pinotti can sprint because these are two riders who don't race against each other very often. But now Pinotti is going to have to go because Rick Verbrugge is coming. It's going to be a tight sprint. Verbrugge is coming well clear. This is a well-deserved win for Belgium and the chase will all be worthwhile. He's waiting to kick again and now he's got it. Pinotti gets second, Verbrugge wins, and it looks like Pataki coming up here as he races to the line. It's known as the Française du Jour, Tossato. Tossato ahead of his teammate there, Pataki, as he crosses the line. So Massimo Maceo Tossato gets it for third place. And that is the breakaway in, and there's going to be a long wait now, Paul, for the next group to come home. But this, and ever such a cool sprint.
That's unbelievable. I've never seen a guy adjust his glasses in the sprint before. He almost lost them there, but he was so powerful. He looked back, he could see there was no shadow coming forward at all. He'd got the win. He had plenty of time to salute the crowd. This is a great win for Lotto and for Rick Verbrugge, the winner of the prologue of the Giro d'Italia this year, and now the winner of a stage of the Tour de France.
As opposed to Alessandro Patecchi, who wasn't, and came in cursing himself for letting the possibility escape him. After 15 stages, incidentally, Italy was trailing the likes of Colombia and Estonia without a single stage win. With no real climbing left in the race, Laurent Jalabert was confirmed as the King of the Mountains, only the third man in history ever to win green and polka dot jerseys in the Tour. No change at the top, though, where all the leaders finished in the pack and the time gaps were untouched. About the only other news of the day was the withdrawal of Jonathan Vaughters, stung by a bee and prevented by the drug laws from using cortisone to treat it. Stage 16 from Castel Sarrasin to Saron was another long one, 224 kilometres of rolling Dordogne countryside, with a quick stop in Biard-sur-Cère, David Moncoutier's home village, where the reception committee seemed to comprise the entire population. Up ahead, the day's escape committee was made up of seven hardy souls who managed to build up a healthy lead of over 20 minutes. With the main pack on the second day of a sightseeing break, one of them was going to be the stage winner. It was just a question of who was going to make the decisive move and when. We join the action now with 23 kilometres to go to the finish.
Trying to get clear right now. The pace is pretty high. There's one rider got an advantage of around about 100 metres, and I would say that's Jens Voigt, because there are no green and white jerseys in this group at the moment. There is Bocharov, so there should be actually two riders up the road right now as we accelerate forward. We get a chance to see who has made the junction. It's the rider from Française des Jeux who's managed to get across there, so this is pretty interesting and pretty important right now.
Brad McGee
has actually seen the move. These two riders know each other very well. Jens Voigt spends an awful lot of time in Australia. He'd be very happy to have alongside him Brad McGee. Now, this is probably the most important move right now, and I'm surprised, Phil, to see that the Russian rider Bocharov from AG2R didn't see this coming.
There's been a crash here, a mass pile-up in a peloton. Now, what on earth has happened here? We suddenly switch back to a lot of Onse riders are standing around there. A bike's lying in the road. It looks as though they're all rising, but what on earth has happened there? A rider on the far right by the barriers doesn't look as though he is going down. Ulrich is there as well, I think. That's Ulrich in the midst of the pileup. Now, we've just switched to this from the helicopter, and we've no information at the moment coming to us at all from Tour Radio. But that is out on the course at around about 25 kilometres from the mean, slightly less than that.
Few riders still down on the ground there. We got a chance there to see Jan Ulrich has gone down. There are one or two riders from Team Telecom who've gone down as well, but I think everybody will be up and riding quite well. There you get a chance to see it's Roman Weinstein's the world champion who is down on the ground. There's a rider from Rabobank in the side of the road that looks very much like Mark Wouters. Théo de Roy is up alongside him at the moment, but that is one of those crashes. There's a Française des Jeux rider who's actually underneath a tree at the side of the road. There's Rudy Pavenage. So in fact Jens Heppner is down as well. Phil Heppner is up there. The blonde-headed riot man there is Rudy Pavenage from Team Telecom. His man is still down, and it may well be that he has a collarbone injury because he's not moving at all. He's just sitting there waiting for the doctor to get to him.
Well, Heppner did have a broken collarbone, the classic rider's injury, and so did Mark Wouters, the second yellow jersey of the Tour, like the first Christophe Moreau, now out of the race. Even worse off was Sven Montgomery, the first man over the Col du Tourmalet 3 days earlier. He'd suffered a fractured skull, the most seriously hurt of five riders who crashed out in that pileup. His Française des Jeux teammate Brad McGee, meanwhile, was still out in front with Jens Voigt inside the final 2 kilometres.
And this is a big effort being made by McGee, and Jens Voigt willing to wait now, try and control him, his excitement here, because neither of these are rapid spins, but McGee might have the edge over Voigt if it were a flat finish. But really, after the way they've had to ride here and the undulations are hard, this is not an easy finish.
It's been 25 kilometres almost at the front for these two riders. The first attack came from Eddie Seigneur, but it was quickly taken up by Jens Voigt and the man who's with him in the white jersey, Brad McGee, right now. They're not far from the left-hand turn, which climbs up to the finish line, and it is a very difficult ascent to the finish line. The man who seems to be the strongest right now, is putting an awful lot of work in, is Jens Voigt. He obviously feels very confident in his ability, but he's up against a great sprinter. McGee has ridden on the track, he's ridden the pursuit and the points race on many occasions, and he will be hoping that he's just got enough left in those legs of his, the very fast legs of a track rider, to beat the German who's with him. They're inside the last kilometer right now. Here is the left-hand turn, and from here to the finish line, it is all uphill.
It is, and that's the place really to attack if you've got the legs left. And 2 kilometers out are the two chasers, Bokchurov and Neil Sorensen. This is the little rise now, and in fact, Jens Voigt is driving the train at the front now, putting Brad McKee in the best seat here as he shadows the man from Germany, who really is an Aussie in many, many ways as well. Because when Jens Voigt took over the yellow jersey for a day from Stuart O'Grady, it was Stuart O'Grady's mum who said he couldn't have gone to a nicer guy.
Well, he's very popular, in fact, throughout the sport of professional cycling, a real gentleman. But right now, he's going to have to try and force McGee to the front. McGee coming up alongside him right now. McGee's legs are ticking over, but I think Voigt is the strongest rider. You can see the face now of McGee. McGee is looking very much under pressure, as you see now that the man in green has got the ideal position. I think he's the strongest.
Well, you know, Paul, I'm almost sure that they're going to go side by side and make the strongest man win. They're not going to try and use each other. They are both facing the wind together, and they're going to go shoulder to shoulder, and the man with the strongest legs will win. And look at the face of Brad McGee here. He's now seen the finish, and Jens Voigt fights on too, trying to hold. This is a dramatic end for these two riders. They haven't used each other's slipstream. They've used their pure strength to go to the finish, and it wouldn't surprise me if that was by agreement. And Jens Voigt races now to his first stage win of a stage of the Tour de France. He's deserved this. He led it for a day, but he'll treasure this victory. And there'll be plenty of more chances for Brad McGee in the years to come. Jens Voigt keeps the dream going for Crédit Agricole, Stuart O'Grady's team. They have had such a wonderful tour, and now he comes clear to victory. A long breakaway today, which has been 150 kilometres in the lead. Voigt gets the stage win. He can have a shower and a sit down before the peloton come in. And the young Brad McGee, in his first Tour de France, has taken a second place. On any other day, he'd have won that.
As it was, the effort almost did for McGee. The young Australian said he was seeing black coming up the final straight. He just about collapsed at the finish. For the Crédit Agricole team, though, a superb tour just kept getting better. A stage win for Voigt to go with his yellow jersey from the first week. And Stuart O'Grady in the chasing pack behind, leading the green jersey competition, ahead of the defending champion, Erik Zabel.
And now it looks to me as though Stuart's got himself in a very good position as well, as now we've got Algon on the right, Vinukarov, and Massimo Tassato is coming on the left, and they're coming up to the line, but all of these places affecting. There's Stuart O'Grady. He could score heavily here if he can get a good finish. Now Zabel goes and grits his teeth. O'Grady stuck to his wheel like a limpet. He'll lose only 1 point, and that's good enough for the day. Zabel comes to the line. Well, he still leads by 12 points. What a great sprint.
Well, that action took place the best part of half an hour after Voigt's heroics, which meant another day of absolutely no change at the top. Armstrong was rolling along happily, knowing he had the time trial to come, and any reordering of the places behind him would probably also wait until then. Much more interesting was the fight shaping up between defending points champion Erik Zabel and the man currently keeping him out of first place.
Hopefully that was my bad day of the tour. I just felt really flat all day, and I think after the heavy weather conditions, the heavy roads, I was pretty stuffed actually. So I was very happy to not lose too many points.
So the last remaining race within the race was for the green jersey, although really a blue collar would be more appropriate, because although he might not be the fastest man in the race, otherwise he'd be wearing the yellow jersey, there's no doubt the points competition leader is the hardest working. Now it's usually referred to as a sprinter's contest, but that's a bit misleading, because it's not enough just to be fast, you have to be fast every day, day in, day out. And since a lot of sprinters don't survive the mountains, there's a definite Darwinian aspect to the points competition. The way it works, for those of you not completely familiar with it, is this. There are points awarded for the first 25 places every day on a sliding scale, depending on the profile of the stage. But there are also points to be won at designated sprints along the route. 6 points for the first man under the banner, 4 points for second, and 2 points for third. So while the yellow jersey can afford to take a day off, hide in the bunch, mark his main rivals and generally pace his effort, the green jersey has to clock on every day and earn his points. And the man who's been out there every day for the past 5 years is Erik Zabel, winner of an unprecedented 5 green jerseys in a row, and not keen on conceding a possible 6th to Stuart O'Grady.
Well, there were 2 intermediate sprints up for grabs on stage 17 to Montluçon, but neither Zabel nor O'Grady got anywhere near them because all the points were scooped up by the daily breakaway, which got away early and eventually boiled down to 3 men, Serge Baguet, Massimiliano Lelli and Jakob Pill. A bit of an oversight, really, by the sprinters' teams to let them get away. And by the time the sporting pinks came out to chase, it was getting late to change the next day's back pages. The lead did come down to around 0.5 minute, but the longer they stayed away, the more likely it looked that it would be a 3-man race for the stage win.
2 kilometres to go for these riders who are still holding on by 28 seconds. Massimiliano Lelli has taken a back seat over the last couple of kilometres and he will try and launch the surprise attack. He's the least best sprinter in the group, but he's the man with the most to gain because Cofidis so far do not have a win at all.
This field has been under constant pressure now for 4 hours and 10 minutes. I'm not sure how much energy the firepower is left in that bunch from the helpers to get the sprinters to the line, because they've not been able to shut down what should have been a quick kill for 3 riders, hovering at 30 seconds now for so long. They deserve the victory for hanging on out there. This is the man that started the move, Massimiliano Lelli. Now, none of these riders up front have ever won a stage of the Tour de France, as Guédon goes back into the pack, and it is Domo, this time it is Fassio Bortolo, who are now driving on. There is Zabel, number 5 in the line, number 6 in the line is Stuart O'Grady.
They've still got 26 seconds advantage over the main field, but I think you're right, Phil, the firepower's gone out of the front end of that main field. These riders have still got to keep working hard together. Massimiliano is playing a very clever game here right now. They're pulling out the referee. They're keeping the gap between the 3 leaders and the main field as clear as possible, because the main field can see these 3 riders. They're right up now. There's the attack coming from Baguet. Baguet's opened up a gap, but Lelli's responded absolutely admirably inside the 1 kilometre to go banner.
Serge Baguet, the master of the late jump, which he did in the Amstel Gold race, now he's going to complain the others have followed him. Well, he may have made a mistake, because Massimiliano Lelli is there. The Danish will be going beside themselves, seeing the champion of Denmark is in this breakaway. This is Jakob Pihl's first Tour de France. They've got time even for a bit of cat and mouse here. Nobody wants to lead. Somebody's going to have to go quickly. Otherwise, the whole field will be on them, because they're just around that far corner. Now they've got the time. As Jakob Pihl looks at them, he doesn't want to be first wheel. He's going to force Lelli to start the gap, to start the jump. As Lelli looks over his shoulder, he doesn't want to lead. Serge Baguet rode his first Tour de France in 1993, took 7 years out and come back last year. Now he's in his second Tour de France since his comeback. Now Lelli doesn't want to go. He's not a great sprinter. Jakob Pihl can pack quite a punch in the sprint. They're forcing Lelli to lead out. So watch for the champion of Denmark at the back. This is the finest moment of his career. There's a chance for the man to score, but now goes Baguet. Pihl gets his back wheel. Baguet's going to have to lead out Jakob Pihl. The whole field is behind, led out now by Tosato, leading out Pataki. And watch out for the green jersey as they come up to the line. Baguet gets it. Pihl is second. Lelli gets third. Now watch at the back as Jan Zverade hits the front. This, and Jan Ulrich himself is going as Zverade pulls clear with Demian Nazon on his wheel. And third wheel is Zabel. And right on the line there is Stuart O'Grady. And he'll be delighted. He's still in green tonight.
And as long as daily opportunists like Baguet kept taking the big points, he'd stay in green. For the second day running, O'Grady had conceded only a point to Zabel, and with just 2 road stages left, that rate of attrition would suit him fine.
Again, the objective was to try and beat Erik in the finish, and got pretty close, but a couple more days to go and it's going to get right down to the wire again.
For the third stage running, the overall time gaps remained static, but as everybody knew, that was about to change.
If Lance Armstrong could win the final time trial, he'd be the first Tour winner with 4 stage victories since Lance Armstrong in 1999. And really, that's apt, because as far as recent Tour winners go, he was racing against nobody but himself in terms of stamping his authority on the event. In fact, to find a Tour winner with more stage wins than Lance, you have to go all the way back to 1984 when Laurent Fignon managed 5. But while Lance was racing only against himself and history, two men behind him were definitely racing each other.
Andrei Kivalev owed his third place largely to the Stage 8 breakaway that had gained him 35 minutes. But this was the overtaking opportunity that last year's third place rider, Josima Bilocki, had been waiting for. No one was going to be overtaking Armstrong, not just because he was the last man to start. On a flat 61-kilometre course, he could easily add a second a kilometre to his lead. By the first time check, he was already adding more. At 21.5 kilometres, he was 25 seconds up on Igor Gonzalez de Galdiano, 34 ahead of Ulrich. At the 43-kilometre check, that had become 1:01 and a minute 23, respectively. Bilocki, meanwhile, was comfortably shoving Kivalev off the third step of the podium.
There is Andrei Kivalev just up the road in front of Jan Ulrich. Ulrich does not seem to be having a super fluid time trial here right now, and he keeps looking down at his pedals as if he's still getting some kind of mechanical problem with that machine of his. He was third at the first time check of the day behind Gonzalez de Galdiano and Armstrong, and in the same place at the second. This is Gonzalez de Galdiano now coming up to the finish. The time to beat is that of Didier Roos. He should do that quite remarkably. It's a long way to the finish line, but this is a tough ride by this man. A very good time trialist. A big surprise in the prologue, and now he should come in with the best time so far.
Well, he was a minute three ahead of Roos at the previous check. He has now got the best time of 1:15:40. With a time in excess of 30 miles an hour for that course for Igor Gonzalez de Galdiano. Now we're seeing Ulrich here go round on the outside of Andrei Kivalev at a 3-minute gap bridge. It doesn't mean a thing to Kivalev. It just means he's 8 minutes behind Ulrich overall now, but he's not worried about that. He is actually fighting now to conserve a fourth place finish in Paris, and Igor Gonzalez is challenging that.
This is a very tricky chicane these riders go through. There you can see Ulrich is through comfortably indeed. I think Andrei Kivalev is a little bit too close to the back wheel of Jan Ulrich. He may well find himself getting a small fine for that. You must, once you're caught, allow a rider to go 20 metres in front of you. If you slipstream, then you will be given a penalty, and the penalty is in relation to the amount of time you stay in the slipstream of the rider in front. Lance Armstrong now, 10 kilometres to go, still flying along over the last 12 and a half minutes of this time trial course today, and the speed there, Phil, is absolutely remarkable. He's probably exceeding 30 miles an hour at the moment, and still that incredible pedalling action.
Bilocki coming home now, still holding on to second, and that's the way I think he's going to make it as he comes up to the line. Big sprint. The Once team have had a wonderful time trial today, and this man will be on the podium in Paris on Sunday in third place, as he was a year ago. All he needs to do now is to cross this line, because he's got all the time he requires in hand as he drops now to fourth place overall, but it won't matter. Kivalev is well beaten, 1:16:48 for Bilocki.
Well, that was a remarkable long chase for Josima Bilocki. He finished third in the Tour de France last year, and he dreamed of finishing third again. He thought that had disappeared with that long breakaway of riders taking 34 minutes over the pack, but his long march to the podium has finally ended today. Armstrong now is 5 kilometres from the finish, and at the 55-kilometre time check, he's gone through with the best time, 1:14 ahead of Gonzalez de Galdiano and 1:36 faster than Jan Ulrich.
Ulrich is accelerating under the kilometre banner. Matter of honour for Jan Ulrich. It hasn't been a great ride. If he comes in, as checks are indicating, he'll drop into second place at the finish and third place when the tornado comes home. But right now it is Ulrich riding up towards the finish and Kivalev doing just enough, and if the referees penalise him, it won't be more than 30 seconds, I wouldn't expect, and that will still leave him in fourth place in the Tour de France. Look at the face of this man.
He's really suffered today, Ulrich. He's gasping for breath right now. He's done whatever he could. He wanted to win this time trial stage, but I think psychologically he might have started just a little bit weaker than Lance Armstrong. Andrei Kivalev in second place has been battling to stay in place with the German, and on a normal time trial course, Ulrich should not have been rivaled by a small man like this. Ulrich is looking to beat the time of Gonzalez de Galdiano. It's going to go very, very close, but I don't think he's going to do it. He was second behind this man at all the other checks, and right now he's going to disappear, and there is confirmation. Ulrich has faded in the time trial today.
Right to the line he comes, the former world champion and silver medalist at the Olympic time trial, beaten by a first-timer in the Tour. Ulrich comes to the line second so far, 1:15:55. And Kivalev's time would be somewhere in the region of 1:19.3. That's just my estimation.
I think I've got a quick glance there of Armstrong going under the 1 kilometre flag, so he's only about a minute 15 away from the finishing line right now. He's into the streets of the town here of Saint-Amand-Montrond, 61 kilometres covered. He's posted the fastest times at every one of the intermediary time checks. This man is proving, Phil, that he's not only invincible in the mountains, in the mountain time trials, but also in the flats time trial stages as well. He has ridden an absolutely perfect time trial here, almost as perfect of the time trials we saw by Miguel Indurain. He's going to beat the time of Gonzalez de Galdiano by around about 1.5 minutes, and that is going to be quite an incredible performance. It will take his victories to 11 stage wins in the Tour de France so far, and that's only just one behind Mario Cipollini.
And Armstrong again wraps up the Tour de France with a time trial win in the last time trial. He did it in Mulhouse last year, and now he's going to do it here in this lovely little town of Saint-Amand-Montrond. He's still got the legs to sprint. It's a matter of honour. We've said that before. He's beating the man that beat him to second place in the prologue at Dunkirk. Armstrong finishes best time, 1:14.16, almost 50 kilometres an hour. That's in excess of 30.5 miles an hour. 1:14.16.
And the time gaps told the story. Only one man within a minute and a half of Armstrong's time, and the second place rider overall, Jan Ulrich, nearly 1:40 back.
I think it's important that not only to win the Tour, but if you're in a position to win and you have the yellow jersey, in my opinion, it's important that the yellow jersey show up and prove that he's the best and prove that he deserves to win the Tour.
Well, after four stage wins split evenly between road stages and time trials, no one can quibble with the authority of Armstrong's win. And Bolocchi's performance now means that this year's podium will look exactly like last year's.
Now, I know what you're all saying over your pints of Kronenbourg and your pastis chasers. When was the last time the same riders took the top three places 2 years running? Well, just in case it comes up in the pub quiz, I can tell you it's only ever happened once before in 1978-79, when Bernaino won, Jupp Zoetemelk was second, and Joachim Agostino took third. And that might be a bad omen for Jan Ulrich, because he's already heading for his fourth second place in five Tour starts. His 1979 counterpart Zoetemelk actually ended up with six. Mind you, with Suardo, Grady and Erik Zabel still battling for the green jersey, Crédit Agricole and Telecom would probably be trying to keep a tight rein on things.
At a relatively short 160 kilometres, it was going to be a fast stage too. Not for Lance Armstrong, who was happily practising his Pilates back down the road, but up at the front, where Erik Zabel, Stuart O'Grady and their respective supporting casts were playing a game of 60-kilometre-an-hour chess as they approached the second sprint of the day, 35 kilometres from the finish in Evry.
The field is all together, and this is now a desperate sprint. We've had two individual attacks from Moran and Eno of Crédit Agricole. Telecom have reeled them in, and O'Grady is now on the wheel. Third man down is Zabel. O'Grady is fourth. This is going to be a tremendous sprint.
Well, O'Grady's in the position he wants to be all the way up to the finish line. He's got one of his teammates on the back. This is Jens Voigt coming up the outside. Oh. Voigt is going to try and surprise them, and he's caused a bit of consternation for the Telecom boys. There is O'Grady, and this was a great move. Stuart O'Grady's got a good man alongside him there with Voigt. Third position at the moment is Erik Zabel, but O'Grady now needs to jump.
But this is going to be a perfect lead out now for Erik Zabel. It's a question of whether he can take the lead properly. It looks like Vinokourov is leading him out. But now it's going to be Zabel. Zabel goes, and Grady. Grady's got to hold on tight and give it his best shot. And he's lost again. 6 points goes to Zabel. Four goes to Stuart O'Grady. He now leads this competition by seven.
And the green was still stuck behind the pink as the two of them headed towards the big points on offer for the day, the final sprint at the finish line in Evry.
This is going to be a tremendous finish with the approach to the kilometre to go. O'Grady is a master holding his position there. He's now in sixth place as he drops behind the Lamprey rider, but pushes him out the way as he hangs on to Zabel's back wheel.
He has to stay there. He knows what he's going to do. And I was talking to Sean Kelly, and Sean Kelly said he will not move away from Zabel at all. The only thing that will stop him will be a crash. And Kelly knows all about taking risks. To be a sprinter, you have to take risks. You have to be a man. You've got to fight. You daren't touch the brakes right now, because if you do, you disappear from the first 20 places. 1,000 meters to go. There is the red kite. And there's a bit of confusion now, because Bonjour are organizing themselves on the left-hand side. Stewie O'Grady is moving back, but he's going to stay right there. His hands off the bars. Don't swamp me in, boys. I need to get this. I've got to fight with Zabel to the line.
Well, they split the peloton here because of the crash and then because of the sheer speed. This is a right-hand tricky bend. As the lead goes on here, Zabel has lost, got away from the wheel of Stewart O'Grady. And there's O'Grady gone through. He's got an awful lot of work to do now as O'Grady. He could be going out of the green jersey unless he can find it, because this is the sprint for the line now. Vinokourov is leading out, but watch out for Sven Turtenberg, because he's got the finish he wants too. As Turtenberg, Christoph Capel about six men down. This is, and Pataki is also not far away from it now. Look at these riders. They're trying to sprint and look where their men are as they're looking for the whereabouts. And in fact, Zabel, they're looking what happened to Stuart O'Grady. O'Grady's far right of a picture. Here comes Zabel, Turtenberg. Turtenberg trying for the line now, being challenged by Roman Veenstein. Through the middle comes Erik Zabel in a green jersey on the line. That's it. Erik is in green. He gets the victory. O'Grady, we think, has crossed the line in third place. That will not be good enough with only a 7-point advantage, but it means this race goes down to Paris. Unbelievable.
Absolutely remarkable. He's a brilliant bike rider. You know, he's fought over the last few years to get himself stage wins at the Tour de France, and this year he's coming away with three. He took two in the first week. He is a magnificent sprinter. He's the most successful bike rider on the circuit this year, and this was great to watch. He was looking over his shoulder, Phil, all of the time, just to see where Stewart O'Grady was, and O'Grady picks his way through the ambush there, because there are bodies and bikes going all over the place, some going forwards and some going backwards. Turtenberg led this sprint out. The acceleration then from Erik Zabel, once he's got the line, is phenomenal.
Now let's see as we go over the line from the area. We know who wins the stage. Veenstein's the world champion. It's close, isn't it? Oh, he could get second here. You know, I think he's got second, Paul.
Well, that is a photo. That's going to have to look at the side view of that. But if he's got second, that is absolutely unbelievable.
Well, he keeps his jersey. He's got second.
He should keep it, because there's a bit of confusion, because Zabel was looking over his shoulder to try and see the position of Stewart O'Grady. He wanted to know where O'Grady finished there. And there, as we come through, let's have a look. O'Grady second, Veenstein's third.
What
O'Grady still in green.
Really is turning out to be. Stewart O'Grady gets only a 5-point loss for second, and it means he leads the competition by 2 points going into tomorrow's last stage.
I think after 3,300 kilometers, just a difference from 2 points between Stewart O'Grady and me, that's very, very close. And I expect tomorrow the winner from the green jersey, it's a very, very happy person. But the second, it's not a loser, it's a big fighter. Yeah.
Bonus sprints are too short to try and come from behind. You have to have a lead-out man, and that's what I'm lacking at the moment. But in the big sprint finishes, you know, it's different. It's every man for himself, or, you know, except for Telecom, who got a fair bit of help. But tomorrow is another day. If it's 0 points, you know, or 2 points ahead or 2 points behind, it's whoever finishes ahead of each other tomorrow. So what a finale.
With all the jerseys usually decided long before the race hits Paris, the final stage on the Champs-Élysées isn't so much the climax of the tour as the cigarette afterwards. Not this year, though. With only 2 points separating Stewart O'Grady and Erik Zabel, the final day was going to be all racing.
The deciding stage of the tour was 160 kilometres, the last 50 of them up and down the Champs-Élysées. The first sprint came after 28.5 kilometres, and it brought the German equaliser. Zabel first under the banner, O'Grady second, and that wiped out the Australians' 2-point advantage. At least O'Grady had the consolation of knowing it couldn't go to penalties. After a brief truce, hostilities were resumed at 78 kilometres, where Zabel's lead-out man Alexander Vinokourov led him out so well, he almost won the sprint himself by mistake. In the end, though, Zabel got it and took the full 6 points, with O'Grady third, which meant, mathematical calculations aside, he essentially had to win the final sprint on the Champs-Élysées to win the green jersey. Well, fittingly, Lance Armstrong's US postal team led the race into Paris, but soon there were the inevitable attacks. A 7-man break, including Zabel's teammate Alexander Vinokourov, got out in front of the pack, and approaching the final lap, they still had a lead of just under half a minute.
The bell this time, there's no tomorrow in the Tour de France 2001. This is it now. Lance Armstrong is 7 kilometres barely away from his third Tour de France win, while these riders here are hoping they've found the legs to trick the sprinters today. They still have a reasonable gap, 26 seconds, and they're saying as we speak, 20 seconds. It's going to be desperately close. Bonjour, Française du Jour, Crédit Agricole must catch them back and give O'Grady, Nazon and the Bonjour sprinters a chance.
The seven dare not now start to play around and play tactical manoeuvres on each other, because they still need to stay as friends for another few kilometres to try and survive off the front of the main field. Now they're in the long straightaway up to the Arc de Triomphe on the Champs-Élysées for the last time, and their gap is now down to 13 seconds. That's right, 1.3 seconds for these seven men at the front. The De La Tour rider on the front is trying to move clear, but that was very quickly nailed back there by the man in white, Fabio Baldato. They've got to give it everything right now if they're going to survive.
Gilles Bouvard leads Fabio Baldato. Alexander Vinokourov. Vinokourov is going to launch a little attack here now, and he's quickly followed by Gert Verheyen. Then comes the Nico Matin, Gilles Bouvard, Mario Hirst. They're all onto the wheel. The last one to react is Bouvard. He wasn't really expecting the move there by Vinokourov. Vinokourov has no interest in the green jersey, and of course he's keeping this breakaway moving because Zabel is now in the driving seat in that competition. Matan has gone now, and this is a rider who could surprise, but look at the panic behind. The field are almost onto them, and it is Stuart O'Grady's Crédit Agricole team who is trying to shut this race down. Then it will go one-on-one, O'Grady versus Zabel.
Nico Matan not happy at all there by the work being done by Florent Bras. He was nailing him back slowly but surely, and that is not a good sign for the breakaway spill. Once they start to attack one at a time like that, they lose the momentum. When every rider in a seven-man break works at the front, you can keep your pace high above 30 miles an hour. But when you start to attack alternatively, the average speed drops down to 27 or 28. While in the meantime, on the front of the main field, there are still three or four teams working very hard to try and bull these seven men back before the finish. 11 seconds is the time gap now. It's coming down slowly, and it may well come all together in the Rue de Rivoli right at the end.
Well, this year there's never been a boring day of racing on the Tour de France, and it's going out on a big high here in a summer's day in Paris. Armstrong is watching from the stalls now because he's done all of his racing before this day. He has all the time in the bank he needs to win the Tour for the third time, but this man wants to win a stage. Nico Matin has taken a flyer down the far side of the road. I would suggest right now he's probably doing 60 kilometres an hour.
He's a huge, powerful bike rider. As an amateur, he was the champion of Belgium in the time trial. He won a time trial this year in the 3 days of La Panne, and he's caught the others hopping. The man chasing him down is Alexander Vinokourov, and he's trying to nail back the back wheel of the Belgian right now, but the main field, there they are. It's less than 10 seconds by my calculations. Baldato is looking over his shoulder, and he can see the whole of the main field in the Tour de France trailing down upon him right now. Huge work on the front by the former yellow jersey wearer, Francois Simon. They're going to pull it all back together in the final kilometres.
Or are they? I'm not so sure, you know. If they can get across the Place de la Concorde, the sprinters may be denied this. They may only get on in sight of the line. But as the leaders go through now, the main field are still a gap. I'll start the watch as they go past our comedy position. You can see the gap for yourself anyway. The field have gone through, Paul, 6 seconds back.
It's going to be less than that right now. You can see the group is attacking. Vinokourov in the pink jersey is trying for the lone lead right now. He is feeling very strong indeed. He's opened up a gap. In fact, that group is going to be caught as we speak. They're still trying to launch counterattacks off the front of it. Nico Matin countering now to try and see if he can just pull back Alexander Vinokourov onto the Place de la Concorde. Next time they come onto the Place de la Concorde, it will be for the last time this year, and that will be setting it up for the big sprinters. Alexander Vinokourov is the sort of rider who could stay off the front of the main field right now, and they're all out for this finish now, Phil. This is when you have to take the risks, you have to stay in the first five or six places.
One man survives of the 23 who went out on the attack, and it looks like Alexander Vinokourov is trying desperately now to score for Zabel and Jan Ullrich's telecom team, because he take away the 35 points, which really Stuart O'Grady wants desperately, and that is why we're seeing Jens Voigt drive the race on for O'Grady. Look at Vinokourov here.
But right on Jens Voigt's wheel there was the man himself in second place in the overall standings, Jan Ulrich. He will try and cause a bit of disorganisation at the front end of the main field. This man now, Phil, has got around about 2.5 kilometres to go to the finish, but there's a huge counter-attack coming up behind him. He's doing everything to try and keep his pace high, but Laurent Brochard of France is coming across the gap right now. Big man Aubervilliers have got a man on the front, and this is the moment to attack if you're strong. Brochard is looking for revenge. He wants to prove that he's a great former world champion, and he will very shortly come onto the tail of Vinokourov, but I think it will be a bunch sprint, Phil.
Into the tunnel they go. Who is going to come out at the head of the group? Vinokourov, Brochard, or the whole peloton? It's going to be Alexander. Laurent is chasing him. The big map boys are trying to pull Christophe Capel in for the spin. They are running out of time so quickly now. Down the Rue de Rivoli. The last time, the Tour de France coming to an end. And in the yellow jersey, Lance Armstrong can watch it all, content in the fact he will be the winner, whatever happens.
Well, the one important thing now, if I was a tactician, I could speak to Stuart O'Grady. I would say, Stuart, don't base your sprint on Zabels. You have to sprint for the win here, because if you can win this race, you will take out the green jerseys. Brochard is inside the kilometre mark now, Phil. 1,000 metres to go, and it's the whole of the main field together. Brochard's last attack now has been caught on the front of the main field. It looks like Eric Decker, but he knows now he's not going to get clear. Francis de Jure are taking up the pace, making Stuart O'Grady is in about 8th place at the moment.
You can see it from the helicopter, just at the bottom of our screen. I don't need to tell you which wheel he's following, because the man in the pink is Erik Zabel. He should own the green by 4 points, but they're going to take each other on one-on-one. And in fact, O'Grady must get over the top of Erik Zabel right now. He knows it too, as Francis de Jure bring them into the home straight now. Jans are out of the big danger there. In third place, fifth wheel is Zabel. Now comes the rush for the line. It looks as though, in fact, Pettini having a little dig as well. But now Jans are at it. He's going to try and clean up for the Czech Republic and Lampring. This could be the win, at least for an Italian team. Zabel gritting his teeth as he comes up to, and O'Grady is out of it, and Jens Arada gets it. Erik Zabel looks over his shoulder, as he's done for the last 3 days, but this time he has won the green jersey. The yellow jersey is owned by only one man, as it has been for the last 8 days, and the winner of the Tour de France is indeed Lance Armstrong. He didn't even give us away, but he's over the line safe.
Well, all he had to do was cross the line safely in that main field, but what a battle that was for Stuart O'Grady. I feel a bit sorry for O'Grady right now, Phil, because he was absolutely perfect throughout this Tour de France. The big man, Jans Verrader, gets the win there. He even has time to look over at all of his rivals, knowing that he got the jump first in the sprint to the line right now. And there he even has time to salute. And what a remarkable win for him, making it his third stage victory. The last time he won was in Cork. That was back in 1998.
And that, in case you didn't know, is in Ireland, where the Tour de France started in that year from Dublin. So Jans Verrader is back. They took a risk putting him in the team. They weren't sure he had the form. Well, they know now. He's not an Italian. He comes from the Czech Republic, but they'll probably count it. He rides for an Italian team. He certainly found a clean pair of wheels there as he ran away to the finishing line. Erik Zabel also riding once more superbly. Clearly the better sprinter than Stuart O'Grady. But that is going to be remembered by many with fond memories as a great competition this year. And O'Grady marginally getting third, I think. And there you are, O'Grady and Zabel. They have fought head-to-head, day after day, and they're still the best of mates.
And between them, they produced the best final stage of a tour since Greg LeMond's dramatic win back in 1989. There's the official confirmation, the prestige of a Champs-Élysées stage win going to Jans Verrader, Zabel and O'Grady second and third in the same time. So an astonishing sixth consecutive green jersey for Zabel, whose son seems to have grown up on the podium in front of an international television audience. All Stuart O'Grady could do was head home, scratch his head and think about what he could possibly do differently.
Win next year. I mean, I'm already thinking about next year. You know, it's it's been a fantastic competition. It's been a very clean competition. It's been fought, you know, right through the mountains. I've searched for points on mountain days when, you know, normally they're not there, and I've just done everything I can. And you know, it's been a battle right to the finish. You know, I've got a lot of respect for Eric, and you know, I think vice versa. And I'm just, someone had to win.
Best green jersey from all the six, because it was a big competition between Stuart O'Grady and me, and to take it on the last day in the last sprint, that's incredible.
Yeah, I mean, you know, realistically, to win the green jersey, I would have had to win the last two stages, which is something I'm yet to do. win big sprints, and shows I'm progressing, but you know, Zabel's just too strong.
The last man to win the green jersey before Zabel, Laurent Jalabert, was a comfortable winner in the King of the Mountains competition, ahead of Jan Ulrich, who must be sick of the sight of second place. For the second year, the young rider's white jersey went to a Spaniard. This time, it was the Kelme rider, Oscar Sevilla. And talking of Kelme, they successfully defended their title as top tour team. The podium placings were a carbon copy of last year too, with the top spot in triplicate. Three wins in a row now for Lance Armstrong, who's fast securing his place among the tour greats. And the margin of victory shows how much work the world's best riders have got to do if they want to challenge him. According to the man himself, it's all down to American enterprise.
That's what everybody's taught when they're growing up. You know, you're supposed to work hard for what you want, and work hard for the big things in life.
So another Tour de France has come to an end with a very familiar top three, the same as last year. We've slipped away from the noise and bustle of the Champs-Élysées to the Jardin des Élysées, because really it's a little bit more peaceful and quiet here. Paul, well, a marvellous performance, not just by Lance Armstrong, as everybody's going to tell us about him, but about some of the other riders in the race too.
Well, you know, I think actually this year Jan Ulrich was absolutely fantastic. He changed his training preparation by riding the Giro d'Italia before he came to this Tour de France, and that made him a lot better and stronger man. But the problem for Ulrich was Armstrong also had improved.
Yeah, and how he's improved. I think that he's ridden his best Tour de France, and that includes the one he won back in 1997. But for me, Paul, one of the highlights of this tour will be the image of Ulrich crashing into the ravine and the great champion Armstrong waiting. He wouldn't beat a man who was down.
Well, that really just goes to reflect that Armstrong is maturing as a champion. He waited for Ulrich, but he still beat him when it came to the big attacks on the final day. But let's not forget Joseba Beloki. I think he did a great ride. He was one of the riders who was actually put 34 minutes behind by that great breakaway on the stage into Pontarlier. The other two, Armstrong and Ulrich, fought back to their podium positions, but it took Joseba Beloki up to the final time trial before he got up into third. And that's remarkable, really, to think that it's exactly the same 1-2-3 as last year, and almost the same time differences.
Absolutely. Well, we hope you enjoyed this video. We've enjoyed bringing it to you. It's been a great Tour de France, most enjoyable in many, many ways. Our congratulations again to Lance Armstrong. He really is the best. For Paul, I'm Phil Liggett saying so long for now. Well, I hope you enjoyed yet another cycling video from World Cycling Productions as much as we've enjoyed bringing it to you. Now, what many of you probably don't know is that I'm also the international editor of Cycle Sport, a fully international magazine which brings you all of the up-to-date news in the cycling world. It brings you profiles and reports of the top bike races and also stories of the men that make the news. And it keeps you up-to-date too with the technical innovations in our sport. I think we produce the magazine using some of the world's best writers. I know we certainly have one of the world's best photographers in Graham Watson. If you love cycling, you should see this book, and here's how you go about getting a subscription. Subscribe to Cycle Sport and we'll send you a free WCP video. Just call the number listed or visit our website, cyclesportmag.com, for a complete listing of the free videos available and for other special offers too. Don't miss this chance. I'm sure you'll love the magazine, and I look forward to visiting you each month through my column. Colnago is one of the perennial favourites of riders on the pro peloton. Why? Because Colnago bikes win races. Over history, Colnago bikes have been ridden to victory in the Giro d'Italia, in the Tour of Flanders, and a record-breaking five times in Paris-Roubaix. In fact, they've won the last five out of six editions of this great event. Now that's one amazing bike. World Cycling Productions is the exclusive catalogue distributor of Colnago frames in America. To see more about these magnificent frames, simply call the numbers on the screen for a World Cycling Productions catalogue, or visit our website at www.worldcycling.com.